Okay, then it seems like the technical part of this seminar is up and running. So first I would like to welcome you all to what I hope will be a very interesting seminar where we will discuss a highly heated up subject, so to say, in the discussion in society today, and that is whether the forest system as we know it acts like a carbon sink or a carbon source. And this is a debate that is very much also related to the use of bioenergy. So that is, at the European level, you hear this every day. In the national level, it comes up every now and then, so to say. But this is a very, very interesting subject to learn more about. And we have been able to invite quite a number of real experts in this area. And we will take you on some kind of journey from the detailed processes at the stand level to what happens at the stand level, at the landscape level, and at the larger regional and national level. So there will be a number of speakers coming in here, and we also, this is also, in some way, I think it's available on the web. So there is some kind of television-looking like activity somewhere. And there are listeners out there. And if some of you that might be listening to this have questions, there is this modern Twitter link with a hashtag of sync or source that you can use. And Annika Mossing, she will administrate questions coming via the internet in some way that I do not understand how it works, but it seems to work. But I'm on the wrong computer. Then we have the program in short is that we have a number of speakers before lunch. Some of you that has reported to Annika, we can say that if you come from the outside, Then there is an availability to get lunch, and then you say Future Forest when you come to the lunch service. And we will have a short lunch break between 12 and 1. And after each of the speakers, there will be a few minutes for the direct questions. But if we have many questions, we will save them up to the discussion at the end of this seminar. So have I forgotten anything important, Annika? I don't think so. Then I would like to introduce the first speaker of today. It's Professor John Marshall. It's imported from the United States to our university. He has almost learned Swedish, but he will give his talk in English. Welcome, John.
Thank you. I recognize a couple of you from my Swedish class, and I know that you'll recognize that Tomas is being charitable when he says that I've almost learned Swedish. You should be happy that I'm doing this in English. There are a couple of things I wanted to say just before I get started to sort of set the scene. And the first of those is a simple but really important point. As somebody who comes from the United States and has been watching my country go crazy over the last few months, I think it's important to recognize the good thing that Future Forests has caused to happen here. This kind of a scientific conversation where people can talk about a subject in different ways and maybe not agree, but at least have a civilized and useful conversation about what's happening is not to be taken for granted. You should appreciate it and take care of it. It's breaking my heart to watch what's happening at home. Okay. The second point I would make is a simpler one, or maybe not. It's just different. And that is that carbon budgets, which is what I'll be talking about today, provide a really powerful tool for figuring out what's going on out there. Budgets in general, but carbon budgets in particular. Of the things that I've done in my life that have made the most difference, all of them, in some way or another, involved an attempt to figure out, okay, there's this much carbon going there, there's that much going there, bang, bang. It doesn't add up. And when it doesn't add up, that tells you something important. In my case, there's been at least three instances where we figured out something different about how the system works, something different from what we thought we knew. If we hadn't tried to do the math to figure out where everything was going, we never would have doubted the things that we thought we already knew. We're talking today about, there's a publication, I'll focus on the Ag Forest Meteorology publication that David and Achim have recently published. We're talking about a situation where a paper's been published that raises some of those kinds of questions. The data say that the system is working in quite a different way than we would expect. Maybe it's right, maybe it isn't, but if it is right, then the system works in a different way than we thought. Maybe there's something interesting to learn about it. So let's work our way down through this carbon budgeting approach. What I'll be doing is comparing the eddy covariance data, and I'm going to describe this eddy covariance technique very broadly because that's as well as I understand it. I'll describe it very broadly, and then I'll compare it to the compartmental fluxes that we've been measuring at another site near Flockaliden, near the place where these experiments were done. So the eddy covariance technique, it's really fairly mathematical and maybe fairly complicated, but in a simple way, here's how it works. It just describes, there's a tower with a wind speed sensor, and in our case, a CO2 sensor, that's measuring the CO2 concentrations of the wind gusts that blow down and the ones that blow up. If there's a photosynthetic canopy underneath that tower, then the gusts that are blowing up will have less CO2 in them than the ones that are blowing down, because photosynthesis has taken some of that CO2 out. The technique basically just takes really rapid measurements of those wind directions and speeds and the CO2 concentrations and adds it up over the course of a minute or a day or a year and figures out, okay, how much CO2 actually was taken up by photosynthesis during that period of interest. Okay? The beautiful, beautiful thing about this technique is that it doesn't require chambers, and so you don't have chambers causing all kinds of weirdness. But it has some of its own challenges, and we'll talk about some of those in just a couple of minutes. Now let's see if I can figure out. Oh yeah. The technique describes the amount of CO2 in this, that comes down through a plane above the ground. It's the height, the plane is at the height of the tower where the measurement device is located. And the technique works pretty well at doing that. That's pretty straightforward. What's not so straightforward is connecting that to the forest underneath. Which part of the forest, for example, are you actually describing? One part of that answer to that question is it's the part that's upwind of the tower. So this wind is blowing this way at the same time as it's blowing all around. And so this area to the left of the tower in this diagram we'd refer to as the tower footprint. That's the area that the tower is actually describing the photosynthesis, the flux over. We'll be talking quite a lot today about several terms that the eddy flux people use. One of those is net ecosystem exchange. That's the balance between photosynthetic uptake and respiratory CO2 loss. It's the net amount of CO2 that's being taken up or given off by the system. This is the measure of whether the system is a source or a sink. It can be positive or negative. Just to make the point that at night, the net ecosystem exchange is always positive. That means that the system, it's positive because this is measured from the atmospheric scientist's point of view. And so CO2 is being added into the atmosphere at night. During the day, it's generally being taken away, and the net ecosystem exchange is negative. If you integrate over a long time, as we'll talk about some more, it can be negative or positive, depending on how big the photosynthetic uptake is compared to the respiratory flux. So that's net ecosystem exchange. And that's eddy covariance in a nutshell. Now, the central result for me, the one that just knocks me out, really, is this description from David and Akim's manuscript that shows the spruce forest near Flockaliden, just up near Vinden, Sweden, shifting over from a CO2 sink to a CO2 source rather suddenly around 2009. The suddenness of that shift is interesting and I guess a little scary. But as I'm about to show you, the magnitude, the size of the shift is also really sort of surprising. I'm going to show you over the course of the next few slides that this difference from it's approximately minus 140 grams of carbon per meter squared per year to approximately plus 140 grams of carbon per meter squared per year. This is an enormous shift in relation to the other things that are going on inside that system. I'll show you this in just a minute. One other point, this is a little tough to look at, but I'll just describe to you what it says so that don't look at it, just listen to me. One of the other things that it says is that photosynthesis didn't change during this period when this enormous thing was happening. So whatever else was happening in that forest stand, whatever caused the shift from source to sink, it wasn't a change in photosynthesis. It was something about the way the system was respiring, something about the way it was giving off CO2. And that's shown here, also from David and Akim's paper. Air temperature on the x-axis, ecosystem respiration rates on the y-axis. These two lines are from the period before 2009. Those lines above are the period from 2010 onward. Something happened in there to increase the respiration rates at any given temperature by, what is it? It doubled or tripled? Okay. So the predictions of eddy covariance can be tested against other methods. I mentioned the carbon budgeting before. Here's where the carbon budgeting comes in. You can look at the carbon pools on the site. That means if there's really this big change in the CO2 flux, that carbon has to be somewhere. Mostly it'll be in trees in a forest stand, or it may be down in the soil, but it's got to be there somewhere, and you can measure that to check to see if the eddy covariance data are right. An alternative approach is to measure each of the components, which are also giving off CO2 or taking up CO2 in photosynthesis. This is usually done with small chambers or chambers on the ground. Then you can add up those fluxes and come up with an alternative estimate of the net amount of the total amount of photosynthesis or the total amount of respiration, and compare that to the eddy covariance numbers. If the eddy covariance numbers are right, and if the component flux numbers are right, they're both uncertain, you can confirm that your numbers are okay. But the question underneath all of this is, how good are the measurements? And the question needs and deserves, and I hope as we go through the day, we'll spend some time on this question, how good are the measurements in the eddy covariance measurements themselves? The biomass and soil organic matter measurements are also tricky, and the component fluxes are not free of error. The friendly challenge I mentioned down there in the lower right is to let's admit that we all have some problems with our measurements, and let's just talk about it in an honest and open way and see if we can't make this conversation go forward quickly and smoothly. So most of the work that I've been doing has not been at Flockaliden, it's been at Rosnadal. Rosnadal, Flockaliden is a spruce forest on till, Rosnadal is a pine forest on sand, but there should be some bit of similarity. So let me just walk you through that. At Rosnadal, we are measuring eddy covariance, carbon pools, and compartmental fluxes. Now there are two issues that I know about with eddy covariance data, because we've run into problems with our eddy covariance data at Rosnadal for these reasons. The first issue is that the system has to be above the canopy, at least 20% above the top of the canopy. The system at Rosnadal for many years was not. This diagram shows turbulence, which is that mixing of the air around the canopy. The dashed lines are the top and bottom of the canopy. You can see that the turbulence, the temperature of the orange and red is where the turbulence is highest. You can see that it's highest in the middle of the day and highest above the canopy. If you get too close to that canopy, the turbulence, you lose the turbulence, it breaks down, and then the eddy covariance system won't work. We had a problem with this, as I said, at Rosendale. As far as I can tell from reading David's manuscript, it looks like they were high enough. It looks like they didn't have a problem with this. But anyway, it makes the point that there can be this issue. The second problem that we had an enormous problem with at Rosendale was canopy decoupling. This describes the fact that in a forest canopy, the canopy blocks the flow of air down below the canopy. And so that air underneath the canopy can kind of get decoupled. It gets separated from the rest of the air. And whatever's happening down there gets lost. At Rosendale, this was telling us that we had photosynthesis going on in January and people. In Vinden, Sweden, there's no photosynthesis in January. And it was because of this decoupling problem. We have a postdoc here, Jörg Joker, who actually solved this problem for us. He developed a method for filtering the data that eliminated those periods when decoupling happened. Here on the graph, I'm showing you that this is the NEE over the course of the year 2014. This is the cumulative NEE, so it's the total as the year went past. You see that in the wintertime, it's positive. That's because the CO2 is just being added to the atmosphere from respiration. Photosynthesis starts sometime in April. It goes negative at that point. The black line at the top is the unfiltered data. That's what we got originally. The red line is the data correcting for this decoupling. It shifted our estimates by 150 grams, 200, I guess, grams of carbon per meter square per year. So it turned out to be a really big change. So it made the system actually a weaker sink than it was using the unfiltered data. But I point out that at the Rosendale site in this pine forest, it's still a sink, and it's a pretty strong sink if you accumulate over a year. So it's behaving in quite a different way from the Flockeliden spruce data that we've been talking about from David's manuscript. Okay, so there are a couple of problems with eddy covariance, but they can be solved. I think it's worth asking whether decoupling, we think tower height was not a problem at Flockeliden, but I think it's worth asking whether decoupling may have been. The site at Rosendale was chosen because eddy covariance people like to have a nice flat area where the wind flows are even, and the plots are actually out on this sand plain. It was thought at the time that this was more or less the ideal site, and so these problems with decoupling were a little bit surprising to us. I should tell you that at Rosendale, there was a heavy nitrogen fertilization. This is like crazy, crazy nitrogen fertilization. 100 kilograms of nitrogen were added per hectare per year. Until the nitrogen started to just leak through the soil, like it's more than the forest could take up. At that point, the nitrogen addition rate was dropped down to 50. But this is still a forest that's being nitrogen fertilized to within an inch of its life. Okay? And we compared that forest to a control forest just to get a sense of how big the changes in the component fluxes and in the eddy flux would be. The idea is, if you take it all the way to the edge like that with all that nitrogen, you ought to see something. And we did. The eddy covariance data are still being worked up from Rosendale, but these are sort of some early numbers. The NEE for the control plot was about minus 240. That means it's a sink. The fertilized plot was a stronger sink. It was minus 360, about 50% stronger. Photosynthesis, you can see, increased a little bit on the fertilized plot. The respiration rates were more or less equal. These numbers I ask you to compare to the changes at Flockeliden up in the upper right. At Flockeliden, they saw it change from minus 140 back in the early 2000s to plus 140 around 2009. So that change is big in comparison to these fluxes. So that's the eddy covariance data from Rosendale. Here's the place where, there it is. We also measured the component fluxes there. And what I've done is to pull some of those numbers out just to give you an idea about sort of the order of magnitude of these fluxes to compare to this shift from minus 140 to plus 140. These numbers on the left are from Hyung-Woo Lim. Are you here? There he is, who published these data back in 2015 from Rosnadal. The litter fall on this site, remember again that we're trying to explain a shift from minus 140 to plus 140. Litter fall on the site and leaf production too were approximately 100 grams of carbon per meter square per year. The stems were accumulating also about 100 grams, 114 grams of carbon per meter square per year. The total above ground biomass was around 260. So the total was about the same as the shift that was being described there. On the control plot, there's a tiny amount of carbon being accumulated in the soils, about 5 grams of carbon per meter square per year. Not really enough to worry about. That estimate, by the way, doesn't come from Rosnadal. It comes from a till soil at Svartberget, and is actually more similar to Flockeliden. But the point is that it's small. We also so we measured the carbon accumulating. We also measured the fluxes, the CO2 that was being consumed and produced using these containers that we placed around the leaves, or we placed them on the stems, and then we measured throughout the season with an automated system. And so using that technique, we were able to get estimates of the CO2 flows and also a soil chamber that measured the CO2 coming off the soil. Again, the difference that we're looking for is from minus 140 to plus 140. On the control plot, that CO2 production from the soil was about 490. This is the big one. This is the place, if it's real, if the change is real, it's almost got to be something about soil respiration. So that was about 490. When we fertilized, we dropped it down to 320. That's getting into the neighborhood of a big enough change to be consistent with what is described at Flockeliden. I'll just point out to you that in the soil, could be something like 6,000 grams of carbon per meter squared. So the soil carbon pool, the carbon in the humus, it's a lot. Most of it isn't being used, it's just sitting there. But if you think about that in comparison to that, it's not so hard to imagine that a small change in the way the soil behaves might give rise to a big change in the way that CO2 is being produced. The problem is that change, 140, is so big that it would consume all the carbon in the soil in about 40 years. And so that doesn't seem very likely. Or at least you can see that it's a big change. I'll leave it at that. I'm going to go now to the comparison of the compartmental fluxes to the eddy flux data at Rosnadal, so you can see that this kind of works. The NEE estimates from the eddy covariance data there we've seen before, minus 239, minus 357 for the control and for the fertilized. Component fluxes, soil, stem, leaf, you add those up. And you add in biomass production, including coarse roots. You add in the accumulation of organic matter in the soil, and you can come up with another estimate of NEE that's based on the sum of all these changes, right? If everything's peachy, the sum of all these little changes should be equal to the sum to the eddy flux estimate for NEE. And you can see that on the control plot, it's like too good to be true. But whenever you find something that's too good to be true, it breaks. And that's true on the fertilized plot. The agreement here is not so good. But notice that even though they disagree by only about 100 grams of carbon per meter square per year. So it's smaller, I guess, considerably smaller than the change that we're looking for, this 280 that occurred at Flockeliden after 2009. So the point is that we were able to make the component fluxes describe the eddy covariance data reasonably well at Flockeliden. This is, I should say, a work still in progress. These numbers are shifting. We haven't published this yet. And so it's there's some uncertainty around this. I ask that we all be clear about our uncertainties. Here's some of ours. There are some of these numbers that I feel a little. If you push me on them, I'll back up pretty quick. Okay. So let's say that the shift from minus 140 to plus 140 was real. If it is, then what happened? And it almost has to be true, as we've seen, that it was due to big differences in the soil CO2 flux. What Hyung-woo actually brought my attention to this yesterday, thank you. There have actually been CO2 measurements from the soil made at Flockaliden. These data are not published yet, and so there was David had no chance of seeing them before. But they're made on a fertilizer trial that's just down the road from the tower. So they should have some, in the same stand. And so they should have some similarity to the stand data. The measurements were made in the late 90s, and then again during exactly those years when this big change in the eddy covariance happened. The blue slashed lines, these, are the controls here. But you can see it in all the data. There was no change, no sharp change in soil respiration on these plots during that time when the big change in the eddy covariance data were, when that happened. This, for me, this makes me question the eddy covariance data a little bit. It's a little down the road. It's a different site. I should say too that these controls, these are plots that were irrigated, so water was added to them, and so they're not perfect controls. But still, if there was a change as big as what they described, you'd expect there to be a change in the soil respiration data around the same time. So I've got a couple of suggestions about what we might do, and I hope we'll develop some more suggestions as we go along here. One of the things I think we should do is check out the stand around that tower. If there was some mortality around the tower, we need to know about that. I know that on the control plots in the fertilizer trial, there was no mortality to speak of, and so it didn't happen there, but maybe. Torgny mentioned to me yesterday the possibility that there's a spruce rust, is it? Needle rust, that hit around 2009 and again around 2012 and 15, that we should be checking to see if that might explain these results. It would kill the new foliage, yeah? Also in the paper, there's data for growth since 2013. We should look at those trees and get measurements of the growth since then. Finally, I think we need to look to see if there's been damage around the tower. These towers are supported by guy wires, and the guy wires could potentially cause some damage to the trees. I'd suggest we get after this, checking the decoupling in the eddy covariance data. And for me, it seems sort of clear that we should be measuring soil respiration around that tower to see if we can detect some. It should be really high if the eddy covariance data are right. So, and we should do that in the footprint. So I'm going to just wind up there. I guess my time is done. I hope, as I said, that we'll have a good conversation about, and that this list will get longer as we go along today.
Okay. Thank you, John, for this introduction, and you already indicated a number of relevant and interesting questions that we could focus a little bit more on, I think, after lunch when we have this section of the seminar. But are there any direct questions to John? Anything from the whatever it was called, this Twitter? Nothing. Okay, but we have plenty of time after lunch for. But there we have something. Can I think we need your microphone? I will run.
You have to be broadcasted. Yeah, my name is Dimitris Athanasiades. I'm working at the Hotel Salou here.
And I was, thank you for your presentation. It was really interesting. I was thinking of maybe it was the snow cover that was removed earlier this year because it was warmer, as you showed in your diagram, and then soil respiration started and was prolonged quite many more months than the previous years that you mentioned. So this could be something that it's that's the effect of this, the reason for this difference. And also my question is if we know how much snow cover affects soil respiration and how it will affect when it gets warmer, as it shows in the figure. Thanks.
No, you're not allowed to shout because you will not be able to shout high enough so they can hear it.
All right. We've done quite a lot of work with, the question was about the effect of snow cover on soil respiration. We've done quite a lot of work with this at Rose Nadal. It may be surprising to some of you that underneath the snow, respiration continues at a pretty high rate. The biology goes basically all winter long. Once the ground really freezes, it gets slow, but it doesn't really stop, as has been shown by Matsu Christ. Is he here? There he is. In some nice experiments up near around Vinden. But during most of the winter, the CO2 flux is fairly high through the snow. And in fact, as far as we can tell at Rose Nadal, it doesn't have very much effect, except right during the time when the snow is melting. When the snow is melting, there are ice lenses formed that block CO2 diffusion. Water is going down into the soil. And during that period, all bets are off. But while the snowpack is more or less intact, it behaves, the CO2 just comes through the snow. It's quite porous. The CO2 concentrations rise underneath because it's harder to diffuse through the snowpack. But the flow of CO2 remains about the same. More detail than you wanted, maybe.
I'm not sure if we have, do we have technical problems? So we have to improvise and find more questions, or can we go on in with the program? As you heard, you have to figure out another question. So there seems to be something with this broadcasting that they are connected to the wrong computer. But I would also like to mention that David, you will be explaining in further detail what has going on at Frakaliden, so we will get more information about that. So we shouldn't solve this question or whatever we should call it at once, and then because the next speaker, if we manage, will also give a broader perspective on these techniques and how the results have been in many different places and many different ecosystems. There was a question. I'm very glad that you do you have a microphone? Perfect.
I brought my own. No, sorry. Jörgen Rudolfi, I'm a researcher here at Wildlife, Fish and Wildlife Environmental Studies. I just have a question as to your measurement there. You showed David's data from several years. So your data, how many years have you been measuring there?
The eddy covariance data started at Rose Nadal in 2005, I think, 2006. But the data were no good until 2014 because the system was too far down into the canopy. And we didn't have any way we didn't account for this decoupling problem that I mentioned. It's only around the time that Georg arrived and developed this correction for us that we start to be able to believe that our data are useful. We're trying to work out whether there's a way to use those old data somehow or not. But maybe Matthias can talk some more about this at some point. It seems, at least for now, that there's not very much optimism among the members of the group who have more expertise on that than I do. The chamber measurements and the the leaf and stem measurements began in 2012 and went to 2014. And so it's a considerably shorter period than David's data series. It's one of the great powerful aspects of that Flocculidan time series is that it is so long. There aren't so many places that can do that.
Thank you.
It seemed that we have now managed to figure out how the technique works. I leave the floor to Anders. You can present yourself. You are like one of the most experienced persons in this subject that you can ever find on the globe. So we are very well glad that you could give priority to this meeting and attend. Yep.
Thank you very much for inviting me. Yes, my name is Anders Lindroth, and I come from both SLU and Lund University, working at both places. And I have been working with this technique, adecovariance measurement, for quite some years. Started in 1993-94 in a forest outside of Uppsala. But I will not talk so much, I will not go to that detail that John did. It was an excellent introduction to the technique. Thank you, John. It was really good. I have some overlap there, but not much, so we'll see how it goes. And I will try to give a little bit the broader picture of how common is it that forests are sinks and sources or sinks, so that we get some somewhat more general view of the whole thing. It will not only be Swedish forest, only a few forests is Swedish in my case, but I will walk you through this and see how it goes. So it's all about forest on the stand level. I have an outline like this. First of all, again, a short introduction to covariance measurements. John has said most of it. I will just give you some small details about it. And then I will use a global data set that I was involved in when developing for a couple of years ago, which includes net ecosystem productivity and net primary productivity, which is closer to what we measure in the forest in the traditional way of okay, thank you. And then a few words on the role of forest floor vegetation in relation to NE, net ecosystem exchange, because that is something that often is more or less neglected in this, in connection to when we talk about the carbon balance. Almost never we talk about the role of the forest floor vegetation. It's only trees that we talk about. So I will give you some information about that. That's not from my own results, but I will show you. And then just a few slides on some results that we had in a Nordic Center of Excellence a couple of years ago, where we had many sites in the Nordic countries, which is maybe more relevant for Sweden and Swedish conditions. And finally, results from chronosequence studies in North America and Europe. And this idea here is to give a better view of what happens over a whole rotation period for a forest, because now we have been talking more about the annual carbon balance, and the numbers I will show you is also in the beginning a lot about the annual carbon balance and not over the whole rotation period over for a forest, which makes a change. So we start with this local scale adecovariance measurements, as John was talking about. The same picture in principle, just showing the footprint that John was talking about. That is that if this is the tower with the equipment he mentioned sitting up here, then what we are measuring is actually an area which is upwind of the tower, depending on how high above the forest or the canopy the instrumentation is located. If this wind is coming from here, we see an area upwind here. It works like this, that the flux that comes from this area, it is transported by the wind, so it's hitting the instrumentation after some short period of time. So that means it's a remote sensing technique. We don't need any enclosure or anything. So in that way, it's a very attractive technique. But there are problems and limitations also with this technique. It's quite nitty-gritty. It looks very simple. If you look at the equation here, the net flux can be expressed as the vertical wind up and down, or deviation of the vertical wind from the mean vertical wind, multiplied by the concentration of the gas that you're interested in, if it's CO2 or methane or whatever. So in principle, it's a very simple method. It's more like measuring directly the flow of gases. And that is, of course, very attractive, and that we measure the net, all fluxes, the sum of all fluxes in this system. Okay. A few things worth mentioning about my presentation. That with the anticovariance method, we measure the net exchange, and that means that the flux is going in both directions, both up and down, and that means that we have to keep track of the sign. And as John said also, a positive NE means that the flux goes from the forest to the atmosphere. It's a source. And then when we have a negative NE, it means that the flux goes the other way, from the atmosphere to the forest, a sink. And that's what everyone wants to have. So this is, we can say, the view of a micrometeorologist, which are the competencies that normally are working in with these measurements. And if we look at an ecosystem like this, we see that the positive fluxes comes from autotrophic respiration and heterotrophic respiration. Both are emitting carbon to the atmosphere. And then we have photosynthesis that is pulling down from the atmosphere. And then it's the balance here that we are interested in, that we call NEE in micromet terms. But then there are biologists, they don't like that CO2 uptake is a negative number. So they define a negative NEE as a positive NEP, net ecosystem productivity. That's a view of a biologist. I think many of you recognize this figure here. So that is, we have to keep this in mind, because I will talk both about NEP and NEE. So if it gets confused sometimes, thank you, we can try to sort it out. So I go now to this review that was made in 2007, and it's published in a paper from Lucer et al. And it's actually, the whole database is published. So if you are interested in using this data, you're welcome to use it. It's available on the net. This is just from the publication. It's called CO2 Balance of Boreal Temperate Tropical Forest Derived from a Global Database. And there is a lot of parameters in this database, and I will not go through all of them, of course, but just a few ones. As I said, NEP, net ecosystem productivity or production, on an annual basis for different sites. Here the data is averaged, so if a site has multiple years of measurements, then it is the average over this time period. But it is not, as far as I can recall, there was no site that has longer data series than 10 years, so that's the maximum. So we can say that it's more or less like an annual average. We have also NPP, which is net primary production or net primary productivity, and that is the gross photosynthesis minus the autotrophic respiration. So it is not it is not the same as NEP, which can be confusing sometimes, because we don't have the heterotrophic respiration in that component. But we can see later on how they relate to each other. And the NPP is closer to what we normally measure in forest. We measure the tree growth and maybe vegetation and litter fall and things like that, which is related to NPP. But it is quite difficult to estimate the real NPP, because there are many components in it, like also the production in the root, in the soil, in the root system. And that is the really hard thing with the turnover of fine roots and so on. So these estimates are, of course, also prone to have some errors, as also the NAP, which is measured with edicovariance systems. And I have only one slide on also the heterotrophic respiration and the role of that. Okay, so the data set is quite large. It's over 500 forests. And as you see, NPP is estimated from almost 300 for 244 sites. And there are more NEP estimates from fewer sites. So that what I mentioned, it was average for per site in this case. And there is also some estimates of heterotrophic respiration. And you see here also how it is divided on different biomes. There is a lot of biomes represented here, and I will show some of these data as well, how the net ecosystem productivity relate to biome and to management. And this is just showing the global distribution of this data set. And you see that it's a heavy overrepresentation in Europe and North America, and very little in the tropical region, few in Asia, but not many. So it's a very, in that way, not very representative data set. But it has a general meaning, I think, for the Northern Hemisphere. Yeah, this is kind of information we can get. Here I have sorted the data with different management, plantation or managed ecosystem. That's the, how looks the color here now? Mm-hmm. Can hardly see it here. What's happened with the colors? It is what it looks like, the light green ones here. And then the unmanaged are the red ones. There are a few clear cuts here, which are the dark blue ones. There are very few managed fertilized sites, which are very special, I would say. So we don't have to pay so much attention to them. And there are also a lot of sites, the light blue one, that are, there was no information about the management, so they're more uncertain. But we can already now see that, I just plotted it against the mean annual air temperature, that we have many sites that are sources. This is now, because it's NEP, the negative numbers are source and the positive numbers are sink. It's a huge variation among the forests, and also both sources and sinks. So for a forest to be a source is not very unusual. This gives a relatively good picture of that information. If we plot it against annual precipitation, we also see a huge variation and no relationship between NEE or NEP, sorry, now I mix it myself. Precipitation. It's just a very big variation among the sites. When it comes to leaf area index, we can see at least that when we have very low leaf area index, we never get any high NEP. But the picture is the same, that huge variation, no really relationship between leaf area index and NEE. Can only see that for when the leaf area index is more than 2, then we seem to have reached what we can say a maximum in net ecosystem productivity, and variation, as I said, is very large across the different sites. Stand age, very similar picture. Now we can see also that we have a few very old sites here, and there seems to be at least a tendency that they might become sources also here. But as there are so little data, so few sites here, it's very hard to say. I don't think we can say that there is a real difference between here and if we look at the variation that we have for the younger stands. So it's not a really conclusive information from this. If we just plot it on another scale up to about 400 years, we see the same. Well, the picture is the same, of course. Seems to be a tendency here, but since the data is so biased towards more information from the lower stand age, it's very hard to say anything definite. But of course, we see that in the beginning here, we have more sources than we have sinks. And I will come back to that when we look at the chronosequences. tree density, in principle, the same scattered picture, no correlation. We can also see here that these fertilized managed stands are probably some kind of short rotation forest. I don't have the exact picture of what it is, but they have very high NEP. They are very dense, but they are intensively managed, so they are probably very different from our natural forest, so to speak. Okay, and heterotrophic respiration, then I expected to see more correlation between sources to the atmosphere and high heterotrophic respiration, but it doesn't really show up here, and there are quite few sites that has both heterotrophic respiration measurements and net ecosystem exchange measurement with the eddy-covariance method. So the data is much less, you see, in this picture. So very hard to say that it's really just the heterotrophic respiration from the soil that is causing the sources. If we look at the similar information, but now divided into different biomes, the boreal humid, the dark green ones, boreal semi-arid, lighter green, a few of these, not so many, but we have a lot of temperate humid forest here, a few also semi-arid, very few. We have Mediterranean warm, which are up here, the dark blue, tropical humid over here, and tropical semi-arid, that's the dark brown here. And of course we see that we have a colder climate, we have lower maximum NEE in the boreal region than what we have in the warmer climate. So that's quite an expected picture. But we also see that we have sources and sinks, as we have seen all the time here. And no clear relationship with temperature, for instance. This is the only really strong relationship that I find here, and that is between the net ecosystem productivity and the NPP. So that means that in general, we can say that, well, 50% of the variation is explained by NPP. So high NPP is also generally resulting in high and net ecosystem productivity, that the carbon balance on an annual level. And that is, of course, what we expected. So that was the information from that global data set. Now some data from the role of forest floor vegetation in relation to the net ecosystem exchange or productivity. Thanks to colleagues in Finland, I got hold of this 3 years of data from a forest gradient in Finland. They measured hard to see here, but this is the altitude map showing that from the higher levels here on the dry uplands forest down towards the mire, which is down here. They had 9 different sites selected, and you can see some of the views of the sites here. And they measured with the chambers and made a component similar to what John was demonstrating, measured with transparent chambers on the ground to get the NEE of the ground vegetation, and then they could actually estimate from the dark measurements, they could estimate the respiration from the soil and also then estimate the photosynthesis of the forest floor vegetation. Looks like this, the results. Now photosynthesis is negative, that means that they follow the micromet terminology here. And the blue bars here, these are the different sites from the higher level down towards the mire. There are, we can say, 7 sites which I would say are forest, and then we come into the mire ecosystem. So the blue is the tree component of photosynthesis. The light green, yellow here, that's the forest floor photosynthesis. And then we have the respiration components up here, trees and soil. And the net ecosystem exchange, now the picture is not very good here, but the net ecosystem exchange, that is the values here. And there are two values for each year, and that because they have used the models to estimate part of the components here. And they have selected, they have two different models. Preless is for the trees, that's the same, but then they have another for the ground vegetation. And so in this case, the net ecosystem exchange is very close to zero, but we have, of course, we have a relatively large forest floor vegetation. Then this site here has a much, much higher uptake. It's a sink, as you can see. This one also sink, similar magnitude of forest floor photosynthesis as to this one site here. And there is some variation. This one, for instance, is also on the balance or actually closer to being a source than a sink. And of course, if we estimate how much the forest floor vegetation fraction of NEE, we get very different numbers depending on how close the balance, how close to the balance the system is. But there is, in no case, there is a less than 30% importance of the forest floor vegetation in relation to the net ecosystem exchange. So it is definitely something that we should consider. Okay, that was short information about this one. Some results from this Nordic network that we had. You see a map here of what sites we had. We had also cropland, grassland, and wetlands involved in here, even one site on Iceland. distributed Finland, Sweden, and Denmark, Sweden, and Finland, and Iceland. And we measured with adecovariance, all this data is from adecovariance measurements on the different types of ecosystems. And I just tried to summarize a little bit of the results. And one thing that we saw that was that the length of the uptake period, that is from when the photosynthesis start and when it ends in the autumn. And there we can see that the length of the uptake period is quite important for the annual net ecosystem exchange. The longer season we have, at least for deciduous forest, the higher is the uptake. Also here we can see there is some years with a source from a deciduous forest. Most of the data from here is from Sore forest, so I think it's maybe only Sore, I don't remember exactly, which is deciduous forest. And for the boreal forest, which are, there are many more forests, they are scattered, they're both pine forest and mixed pine and spruce, it's a more scattered picture. But also there is at least a clear tendency that the longer uptake period we have, the bigger will be the annual net ecosystem exchange. And we can maybe have this in mind when we discuss David's paper later on and come back to that. And if we summarize this summary of all existing sites, including some disturbed site, windthrow sites, and clear cuts, that are the big sources here. Now we talk about NEE, so positive means source. and then the big sinks that are short rotation forest, which I also included here. But there is the same picture as I showed you from this global data set, that we have everything from a source to a sink, and a very different sink strength for the forest. There are also, let's say, coniferous forests that are sources, but most of them are sinks, so that's dominating, of course. That's a picture from the Nordic study. Finally, something from the chronosequence studies that we have made. As you all know very well, even-aged silviculture dominate in boreal forest, and it's of course interesting to know how this method is affecting the carbon balance. So the only really good way of doing that is to use chronosequences where we have the same type of soil, we have the same climate, and we have the same type of forest in of different age, from a clear cut to an older, mature forest in the end of the rotation period. And we had a European collaboration where we measured on five different chronosequences in Sweden, Finland, Italy, UK, and France. The data, now we have NEP here to make it confusing. That means that negative values are sources and positive values are sinks. We have a lot of sources in the beginning of the rotation period of the age, as we could expect. And the similar results was obtained in North America chronosequence studies, where they also found very similar relationship. And the conclusion from these studies is that clear cuts are sources during the first about 7 to 15 years, depending on the local conditions, and with quite large emissions, 200 to 500 grams of carbon per square meter. If you remember Jan's values, it was about 150, something like that. Rosenedal was 250 something. So you get some perspective on this. Well, we used the European chronosequence data where we had the best information and control on to develop a very simple method where we can express the net ecosystem exchange as a function of stand age. In this, the model was such that it was scaling against the normal rotation period and the maximum NE for that system. And this is just an example for a typical 100-year rotation in Sweden, where we have the losses here during the first about 10, 12 years, and then it takes about the same time to gain what we lost here in the beginning. So after about 25 years, we start to gain more carbon than we have lost previously. And that the curve looks like this, with a decreasing NEE when the stands become older. But I would say that the curve form here is quite uncertain because we don't have very many sites of the older age. But that is the general picture. And another thing is that if we look over the whole rotation period, that the mean net ecosystem exchange is about 50% of the maximum. And that was what we found for all of these chronosequences. So there is some potential maybe to have increased the mean value over time. So my take-home message is that we have a large variation of annual net ecosystem productivity across management strategies and biomes, as I have shown you. We have lower NEP in the colder boreal biomes as compared to warmer ones. There is no surprise in that, but no real relationship with precipitation or water input. Disturbances are causing large emissions during relatively long period of the rotation. Photosynthesis of forest floor vegetation can constitute a highly significant part of the net ecosystem productivity. Not if we compare it with a tree NPP, but if we compare it with a net, because then we have the closer to the balance. And maximum NEP occurs after a leaf area index of about 2, a little bit more than 2. We have a quite strong relationship between net ecosystem productivity and NPP, with about 50% of the variation in NEP explained. And of course, forests are sinks in general, but sources occurs relatively frequent. So that was my presentation. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Thank you very much, Anders. Now I think we have in a way, we have been guided through the more detailed processes, and also you have got a general picture of what happens when you add them up on the stand level. Next speaker will be David Haddon, that you have heard been mentioned now a few times, and he will give us some more insights and information about this flock-a-leading experiment and the results that has come up there. But before David give his talk, there might be some questions in the audience, and I think we have need some time for making sure that your talk is on what computer? On the big one.
It has to be shift.
Then we have to shift. But you did well last time as an audience. Now you know that you have to figure out a few questions to Anders, so we can shift from one computer to the other.
I can take this one. Okay, any questions?
Thank you. My name is Paul Trites, and I'm actually visiting from Queen's University in Canada. I'm wondering if you had a slide. Oh, we're going to lose it. Where you plotted, I think it was temperature against NEP by different forest types. Yeah. And I think your point was, and we went through that fairly quickly, but the point was, in general, when you had all those forest types together, there was no trend. But it looked to me when you had looked at the different forest management types, there would have been different slopes to the trends that you had there. And I'm just wondering if we could sort of explore that for a second.
The one with the management.
Yeah.
Yeah, okay. Yeah. Against temperature, for instance, or?
Yeah, I think it was temperature, mean annual air temperature, think.
This one.
Yeah, so if you looked at the different management, if you separated each type,
yeah,
the slope seemed to change between, if I'm just trying to picture it, but if you looked at them individually, there would be some trends there, I think, and the slopes would change by management type, so I think looking at air temperature as an effect on NEP, the management types have a huge impact.
Yeah, I mean, but the problem is again that it's very uneven in terms of number of sites, and that's always a problem when you want to do this because the variation is so large. So I'm not sure that we really get significant differences from this. I'm afraid that it will be very, very difficult. But it's definitely interesting, and I think we should try to continue to collect data like this so that we can say something and also have more information about what is the management, because management is not just the same thing everywhere. So that's also important. And I'm not really sure. I don't have all the details about what the management was here and what the unmanaged means in this context.
Thank you. Very interesting.
Yeah. Another question there? Yeah, take it away.
Thank you. My name is Jonny Schimmel from Forest Ecology and Management. I found it interesting when you were talking about your chronosequence, the graph you showed there. Can you say something about how it would differ if you're talking about managed old forest or unmanaged old forest? Do you have any thoughts about that?
I don't think we have that variation in the material that we had to do this simple model here. So I think I would be quite cautious to apply it. This was the traditionally managed forest where we had, I think, at least I know the Swedish and Finnish, where you have the thinning and the normal, what we call normal management systems. And it will be very hard to say anything about that. We are doing measurements in a very old forest in the north of Sweden, But this is not a clone sequence, so it's a natural forest, but it's an unmanaged forest, and that's why it's interesting. But it now it has not been managed for as long as we know. And what we have seen so far, we have about 4 years of net ecosystem exchange measurements now, that it's a very, very small sink. I'm not even sure that we can say that it is a sink, but it is close to balance, but not really. It's a small sink. So that is probably, but it's a very sparse forest because it's up in the harsh climate. So it is also, we have to take this into account as well when we compare this. You saw some of the old forests here. They were quite, some of them were quite substantial sinks actually. So it is not just saying that an old forest is a source. It can also be sinks. So there are many factors here coming in.
Okay, now I think, did we have some more questions already, or was there another one? Last question.
I was just wondering about the same graph that the person in front of me, which is a compartmental, but then with the leaf area index. Because you show, your conclusion from that graph was that the maximum NEP occurs at a leaf area index bigger than 2.
2, yeah.
But I would say, what is then, so if you have a leaf area index lower than 2, you often have a lot of forest understory. And I think in your graph you showed that everything below it and 2 was a source. So
no, not that, not everything. It was a trend.
But a large proportion was a source. So I was then wondering, what is then the? Wouldn't that suggest that there's a very important contribution of the understory, forest understory, in making the forest a source?
Yeah, I mean, I don't recall exactly the details about the forest with the lower leaf area index, but it was, I think it was both unmanaged, or no, it couldn't have been unmanaged forest in that region. It must have been managed forest. I have to look.
Yeah, I was just wondering if then interaction between different functional groups in vegetation, if that would then enhance the whole ecosystem being a source, rather than if you only look at trees. Well, just a thought.
Yeah, maybe it's a good question. I can't give a good answer, I think. But it's important, yes. Okay.
Yeah. Well, thank you, Anders, for your talk. And now it's time for David to give us some deeper insights in what actually happened there up at Frökaliden these years.
I will try. Yeah. We'll see.
Welcome.
Thank you. Is this the one for working or?
No, now it's.
I see. Okay, fine.
Yeah,
that's super.
And you see this is the next slide.
Okay. Yes, so my name's David Haddon. I'm going to talk about a paper that I published last year during my PhD with Achim Grelle. A lot of the slides that I'll show, John has already shown today, but it's good to get repetition. So the paper was titled Changing Temperature Response of Respiration Turns Boreal Forest from Carbon Sink to Carbon Source. And it was based on 17 years of data recorded at Flakaliden, which is in the north of Sweden, just outside Umeå here. And this site was set up in 1996 by Anders Lindroth and Achim Grelle. And it's been a part of some international networks, Euroflux, Carbo Europe, and national collaborations, Lusta, for example, and Fomaflux. So the forest is about 60 years old just now. And we've been measuring continuously for 17 years when we published this data, using a closed path system. Here's the forest, nice green canopy from above, and here's our measurement system. Again, above the forest canopy, because we're using the eddy covariance methodology. I won't go into the methodology here, I think it's been touched on already. I'll just explain our system. So when we first looked at the data, we saw that the forest was acting as a net carbon sink. Here, a downward value is a sink, and an upward value is a source. I look at it from a meteorological point of view. And we see that, the first few years, the forest was a sink, as would be expected from a productive forest. However, in 2010, this shift occurred, and the forest turned into a net source, losing around 1.5 tons of carbon per hectare in 2010. 12. But we see that this interannual variation, it's quite stochastic, it's quite variable. We have some years where we have large uptake and other years we have very little uptake. So it's a lot of variation year on year. And this shift, yes, it was quite drastic and dramatic, but if we look at a slightly longer period, we see that our uptake is gradually declining, and then it shifts. So I just want to look at this. Here we have the net ecosystem exchange again. On the x-axis, we have January until December. And here we have the year 2000 until 2013. Blues are net uptake, and yellows and reds are net loss. And when we look at this, we see something happening here and a little bit here. Large net losses in the autumn and the springtime, which weren't really occurring in previous years. We had fluxes close to neutral. And we see large uptakes in the summer months as well. So this indicated to us that, yeah, respiration seems to be occurring, or net losses are occurring in the autumn. Then we separated our net fluxes into the gross components. I won't go into how we did that today. We can always talk about that afterwards. Here we have our total ecosystem respiration. And we see that, yeah, we have more respiration in the spring and also in the autumn, some more respiration occurring than we did previously. Here we have a lot of blue. In the winter time, very small fluxes are occurring. So there's a lot. Respiration is more or less suppressed during the winter period. So here I show the accumulated values. We have the entire measurement period on the x-axis, and our accumulative value here, I think it's in tons CO2 per hectare. The solid black line is our net, accumulated net balance, and we see that we have a downward going line. So our forest is acting as a net source, a sink, sorry. But here we have respiration, and we see the line is more or less linear. But then in 2010, this line starts to creep upwards. It bends up, which indicates that we have a slight change in gross respiration. Here we have gross uptake, and this line is more or less straight. We don't see any change in the line, really. It's quite consistent. It's hard to see, and that indicates that small changes in any of these gross components has a large impact on the net ecosystem exchange. So this indicates that, yeah, respiration, rather than a change in photosynthesis, is perhaps the driver for this shift that we saw. Here's a graph that John didn't think was so pretty, but I quite like it. It shows the autumn and the spring. And here we have the black lines are respiration, and the gray lines are GPP. And what we see is that, yeah, it's very stochastic. We have lots of variation, interannual variation in both components. Large variations in respiration, but also large variations in GPP. But if we look at the whole time series, we see that a very rough trend line, it's not very nice, but there is a trend towards more respiration occurring in both the autumn and the spring, whereas the GPP seems to be quite stable, no large trends in the whole time period. So when I first saw this, it reminded me of a couple of papers I'd read previously. Quite scary titles. Autumn warming reduces the CO2 sink of black spruce forests in Alaska, for example, and the net carbon dioxide losses of northern ecosystems in response, to autumn warming. So they're saying that autumn warming might cause increased losses from the ecosystem. I thought, well, we are seeing this in the autumn. Let's have a look. So I looked at our climatic data, and I didn't see any change. It's only 17 years of climate data, but I didn't see any trend towards a warming effect that these other papers were seeing. And in fact, the years when we had net losses, this period, we had a decline in temperature. It wasn't getting warmer, in fact, cooler than the years previously. So I sort of ruled out that climate change or a change in temperature wasn't the main driver for this. So rather it might be something, a change in ecosystem functioning, something's happening within the forest that's causing this loss. So you've seen this picture already today. I did a temperature response function for respiration. Here we have temperature, -5 degrees to 10 degrees. And here we have our respiration. And yeah, this line is, these two lines are before the forest turned to a net source. So while the forest was a net sink, and this is when the forest was a net source. Here we have springtime, and springtime after net source, and autumn time when it was a net sink and net source. And what we see is that we have increased a change in the response to temperature. At the same temperature, we now have more respiration than we did previously. But looking at these lines, the slope and the curve are more or less quite similar. But the elevation has changed, which indicates to me that there's an increase in base respiration. There's now perhaps more substrate in the ecosystem that can be decomposed. To confirm this, we did a sensitivity analysis. So I, for the period when we had a net sink, source, I applied the average temporary response for this time period to this data to see what would happen if the forest was responding as it did here, when the forest is a source. And when I did this, it converted the forest, or our data, so that we were now seeing that the forest would be in its sink if it was responding the same way as it did here. So this strengthened my thought that a change in temperature response has driven the forest to being a net source from being a net sink. So what's the reason for this shift? I don't know, and I hope some of you will come with good suggestions today. But we have seen that shift, and we're trying to understand it. Let's have a look at the forest stand. It's predominantly spruce. There are a few pine, but not very many at all. And there are 2,200 trees per hectare. And I think that's quite a lot, quite a high density. So from above the mass, it's nice and green. But when we climb down and walk into the forest, we see it's relatively dark. There are a lot of dead branches on the trunks without any needles. The needles have fallen and are on the ground. Vegetation, it's ground vegetation. It's mostly moss and some blueberry. And yeah, it looks like that. So it made us think, if it's dark and we have all these dead branches, this is a sign of self-pruning, a lack of light getting into the understory. The trees might be self-pruning. It stimulates this death of the understory branches. Perhaps that is causing an increase in respiration as they decompose. So flaccline actually was due to get thinned. And in December last year, thinning occurred on our site, and they took out 1,027 trees per hectare, which equated to about 55 meter cubed of biomass per hectare. But when they did the thinning, we asked them if they would leave us a small pizza slice, so to speak, as a control where thinning didn't occur, so that we can compare the thinned stand with an area of unthinned to see, is thinning, does that have an impact on our carbon balance? Will the forest now act as a carbon sink? And time will tell. The Sveaskog, I don't know if Anders Eriksson is here today, but he got back to us saying that a lot of the trees that they removed were suffering from rot. I don't know what kind of rot it was, he just said rot. And that was quite interesting. He also mentioned that the spruce top shoots were short, and that indicated that perhaps on this site, the conditions weren't optimal for spruce growth. But this idea of rot made me think. When I just published this, Per Erik Jansson from Cote Ho got in touch. He works with the COOP model, and he wanted to try and to model our results. And he sent an email one day of this. The blue line is our measured data, and the red line is his model data. This is not by any means a refined model. It's just something he did quickly just to get discussing. And he wouldn't tell us how he got this to fit until we met with him. And he took us to his garden and he showed us a tree that he cut down. And he was surprised that when he cut down the tree, the centre was more or less hollow. It had been decomposed, it had rotted away. And he got the idea that he built in a parameter to his model that he called wood eaters. And it was some form of perhaps rot or something that was affecting the trees. And he just placed that this parameter would take effect from here. But it followed nicely our curve. That's not to say that is the driver. The model has to be refined, but it's a possibility that this is having an effect along with a lot of dead biomass accumulating. But we don't know for sure. So what about these results? We should put them in a wider perspective. The forest has shifted. We don't know exactly why. We can only speculate at the moment. But what does it mean? I mean, the measurement period was only a fraction of a forest lifespan of a whole rotation. It was only 17 years we presented, which isn't that long on the scale of things. If we'd stopped measuring here, then we wouldn't have caught this shift. We wouldn't have captured the shift that occurs. And we've said, this forest is acting as we'd expect. It's being a net sink. So this highlights that it's really important for us to measure over long periods of time. Because it is stochastic. Things do happen. The forest it varies interannually. It might act as a sink, but who knows? It might also change back to being it acts as a source, but it might become a sink again. And I don't think that carbon can be indefinitely taken up by forests. There must be some sort of feedback. The system can't store carbon forever. So there is going to be variations, I think, and perhaps that's what we see. It might only be a very short-term variation. This loss that we see might well be a sink again soon. It's just part of nature, perhaps. But we should also consider our measurement period. Although currently the forest is a net source, if we accumulate the values, then from the start of measurement till now, the forest on that scale is actually a net sink. It's still taken up more carbon than it's lost over this time period. So when we're talking about the carbon balance of forests, we should really, really consider time scale. Are we talking thousands of years, a few years? This is important to consider. Along with spatial perspective, we have only been measuring on one single forest stand. It's only a small part of a greater landscape. So what does it really tell us? Well, it definitely doesn't tell us about a national carbon balance, but it does give us an insight into the processes driving carbon fluxes from this forest and perhaps similar forests. And on top of that, what we can learn from this, if we can understand what's happening in the system, then we can perhaps improve coupled climate models. So we shouldn't write off this study system because it's relatively small scale. It's still a valuable tool. And Achim suggested I include this. This is the number of sites that we're working with just now, and a total of 19 sites Achim's working on. And they're a variety of forests and agricultural ecosystems. We have a number of clear cuts, forests of varying ages, some agricultural landscapes. So if we can understand the processes driving fluxes from these areas, then we can really get a good understanding of the processes behind it, behind respiration or photosynthesis, and improve, for example, models. But if we sum the total area from these 19 measurement sites, it only accounts for 1 square kilometer. And Sweden as a surface area is in fact 450,000 square kilometers. So we have a very long way to go if we want to cover the whole of the country with this. But as I said, it's a good tool for understanding processes. And then lastly, here we just have a year and our accumulated flux in tons per hectare. It's just, I think Achim just put on some random years here. Here we have flaccoline when it was acting as a net sink. So we have a strong carbon sink here. Here we have a willow plantation, for example. Here we have the zero. So we have some forests or ecosystems where we have net losses. They're predominantly stump harvested sites, for example, or young, very young forests. In fact, even a urskog is here. The the carbon balance is near neutral, a slight source. I hope that gave a little insight into the paper, and yeah, I'm sure it's going to create a lot of questions. But that was it from me.
Okay, thank you, David. I think it was really interesting to get some further explanations on how these measurements has been conducted and more about the conditions of the site. And I think that we have all agreed on that it's a little bit of a mystery that you see this shift, and that we, at present, just now, we don't know the reasons for that, but you indicated one explanation. I think that we heard already from the audience that there might be more, but it seems to be related to increased respiration losses, which means that there has to be some kind of source for these losses. But we can discuss this further, I think, after lunch. And I'm sure that before we leave this room, we will have at least one or two really good ideas about how to explain this, and that we might be able to elaborate a bit further than in the future. But if you have any direct questions now to David, you can ask them now. We have one there from Skogforsk.
Okay, thanks. I was just wondering, you talked about this stochastic variation that you see. Can you estimate or give some clue about how large part of that variation is really due to the system changing, and how much may be due to the measurements?
Yeah.
I'm thinking about wind changing the footprint area, and if the wind differs between years and so on.
Mm-hmm. So I did have a look at the footprint of Flakkaliden, and the wind, we don't have any prevailing wind direction. It's quite homogeneous throughout the year, actually. So I wouldn't think that is going to have too much of an effect. Whereas on one of our other sites, we do have a prevailing wind direction, and that does impact our measurements quite significantly. But we can account for that somehow. I think the variation that we see is largely driven by weather, for example. We have warmer years, we have wetter years. As the forest ages, it will react differently to different input or different variables. So to understand these interannual variations, that's really, really tricky, actually. But I don't think it's entirely a measurement issue. I would suspect it's largely variations in the ecosystem.
Yes, Torgen Esson is my name. More of a comment or a suggestion for a potential contributing factor. There was a massive outbreak of spruce needle rust at Kyrysomyxa in 2009, causing litter fall to triple, actually. So you would have a much larger pool of carbon coming down.
Yeah. I suspect that's partly what we're seeing. And there is a lag effect of that. The litter fall will fall, and it will take some time before it's decomposed and we start to have this output. And I think this, we saw the dead branches, I think that's a large contributing factor, at least, to what we're seeing.
Okay, but I think we will leave it with that. And thank you again, David. Now we will leave the stand scale. And as David said, that to get wider perspectives, we also need to consider the landscape scale and the regional scale. And Matthias, he will guide us through what happens in a managed forest landscape in the boreal zone, I think.
Yes. Do you have the pointer hooked up?
I think it's done.
Okay, thank you, Tomas, for the introduction and the invitation to this seminar today. My name is Matthias Peichel. I'm a researcher at the Department of Forest Ecology and Management at SLU. And I have been involved in the past years in measurements at the various flux stations around Vindeln, mostly the Degre peatland, but also the Rosenedal forest that we have been hearing about earlier today, and the Svabberget forest. And today, I want to contribute to this discussion today with some recent results from a project that we have recently established, which aims at evaluating the carbon balance of managed boreal forests at the landscape scale. Okay. It worked. Okay, so forest, I want to start with highlighting that forests have been identified as a key component for reaching climate mitigation goals in recent national and international policy frameworks, such as the Swedish Roadmap 2050 and the United Nations Paris Agreement, which has been recently ratified in November 2016. And to reach these goals, it's important to have accurate accounting of the sources and sinks on a national scale. And forests are considered as a tool because they're generally considered as a sink for atmospheric carbon dioxide. And they could also be subject to additional silvicultural measurements that could enhance this sink potentially. However, if we look at the landscape scale, there are a variety of different forest stands at different development stages. And we have already heard earlier in Anders' talk, for example, that the stand level carbon balance can vary manifold throughout a forest lifetime, changing even between source and sink and peaking at different periods of development stages. Even within a same development stage or forest age class, there can be further variations in the plot in the stand scale carbon balance due to differences in species composition, soil fertility, and other soil properties. There can be additional impacts from management activities such as thinning, fertilization, or drainage ditching. So when considering all these different stand-scale carbon balance over a larger landscape, it becomes more and more challenging to actually provide a number for the average carbon source sink strength on such a landscape scale, which therefore remains rather uncertain. In a managed landscape, we also find clear-cut areas, which you saw on the earlier figures, can be very large carbon sources, and it has been suggested that on a landscape scale, these sources could be even turning the entire landscape into a carbon, into a net carbon source. Apart from these forest carbon fluxes in the landscape, carbon can also be transported laterally with streams in the form of dissolved organic and inorganic carbon and potentially exported from the catchment. You also find other ecosystem types on the, in the boreal landscape, such as lakes and mire ecosystems, which contribute to the overall biosphere-atmosphere exchange of carbon. And finally, there's also a lateral carbon flow below and above ground that goes beyond the interface of terrestrial and aquatic systems, which is usually not accounted for when assessing the carbon balance at a stand level. So this diagram has been turning out to give a clear picture of this, the major challenge, which is the spatial but also the temporal heterogeneity of a forest, of a managed forest landscape. And one example from a real world example is this image here that shows these different elements across a landscape. And when summing up the various fluxes from these different elements, it remains in the question, it results in the question, is such a landscape in the end a carbon sink or a carbon source? To address this question, we have initiated a project in which we want to estimate the carbon balance of the Krüchlen catchment. As you can see in this image here, the Krüchlen catchment resembles a typical boreal landscape, mostly forested, with occurrences of mires and lakes. The Krüchlen catchment is located in the boreal region, close to the town of Windeln. And you can also see that it's in the vicinity of the Rosinedal forest and the Flakkaliden forest sites, which have been shown earlier today. So they're all exposed to similar climate regimes. And it's also close to the Dagerö peatland. The area, the total catchment area is 68 square kilometers, out of which forests cover 87%, and mires cover 9%, and are mostly located in the northern part of the catchment, where also the majority of the lakes occur. And you can see at the southeast corner of the catchment outlet of the stream network, indicated by the arrow. The soils are variable throughout the catchment and are predominantly till and peat soils in the upper half of the catchment and sandy sediment soils in the lower half of the catchment. And the grid with the black dots indicates the location of over 500 forest inventory plots distributed over the catchment. And the yellow star indicates the approximate location of the new ICOS Svabberget flux tower station. We also have high resolution LiDAR data, which can be used to estimate the biomass at a very high resolution across the entire catchment. Here you can see a nice illustration of how the biomass varies over the landscape scale from basically zero to quite high numbers. So to estimate the carbon balance of this catchment, we use two approaches to constrain our final estimate from two different estimates. The first estimate is a traditional bottom-up type approach, where we first estimate the plot carbon balance based on tree growth measurements to estimate NPP and soil carbon losses on the plot scale. We conduct measurements of lake and mire carbon exchanges within mires and lakes in the catchment and surrounding. And we use the LiDAR data to upscale these vertical fluxes across the entire landscape. We then combine the vertical fluxes with the lateral estimate of carbon export via the streams to arrive at a total net landscape carbon balance. As you can see, this approach requires a number of measurements which all have some uncertainty and relies on some assumption when being upscaled over the landscape. So this propagates to quite some uncertainty in the final estimate. Therefore, in a parallel approach, we try a more direct top-down estimate by using eddy covariance measurements at a height of 70 meters, which results in a footprint in a measurement footprint that integrates all vertical fluxes over the landscape, which then can be combined with the export of carbon via the streams. Here you can see on the left side a couple of images from the Svabberget tall tower. And on the right side, you see an illustration of the instrumentation on this tower. This tower is part of ICOS Sweden and has been instrumented over the recent years with, you can see the green triangles here on the left side showing gradient measurements of temperature, CO2, and water concentrations. And the yellow stars here indicate where the eddy currents systems are mounted for measurement of eddy currents fluxes. And then there's a number of meteorological and soil environmental variables that are also measured at this site. And today I will show the results from this measurement system, where we measure the net ecosystem exchange based on the turbulent exchange at 7 meters height, plus the change in the storage, which we get from the soil from the gradient measurements. This image shows the footprint of the eddy currents measurements. And it's based on the Cleon 2015 footprint model. And anything that is inside the red line is the area that together contributes 90% to the flux. You can see that we, in general, cover most of the catchment, although we have some contribution from outside the catchment here in the northwest corner, and we miss a part here in the southeast corner. This figure shows the cumulative fluxes over 11 months. This is how far we have measured so far. And in green, you can see the gross primary productivity. In red, the total landscape respiration. And blue is the net balance of these component fluxes, the net ecosystem exchange. And negative values indicate uptake. Positive values indicate emission. And over this 11-month period, we end up with a cross primary productivity of about 8.7 tons of carbon, which is about 170 grams carbon per square meter. I have converted everything to tons carbon per hectare in my presentation now, but the scale gives you an indication of the grams carbon per square meter, if you prefer that unit. And the total respiration is 7.34 tons carbon per hectare, which results in a net uptake of 1.36 tons carbon per hectare over this 11 months. This figure then shows the total over 1 month of these two component fluxes, GPP in green and respiration in red, and the net balance in blue. And you can see that there's a shift between the seasonal dynamics of productivity and respiration, with an earlier peak in uptake compared to the peak in the respiration. And this phase shift then results in the greatest net uptake by the landscape occurring quite early in the season already, here in June. And the highest emission were observed in December. If you then add the losses in February for the sake of getting a full annual budget, just based on averaging the March and January losses, then we end up with an annual net uptake of about 1.1 tons carbon per hectare, which is equal to 110 grams of carbon per square meter per year. We also have measurements in nearby mire and lakes ecosystems. Long-term measurements at the nearby Dago peatland suggest that over the long run, we have an uptake of about half a ton of carbon per hectare per year. And first estimates of measurements in lakes within the Kirkland catchment indicate that the lakes may represent a source in the order of about half a ton of carbon per hectare per year. The annual stream carbon export, which is measured at the outlet of the catchment here, suggests that a multi-year average of 0.05 tons of carbon being exported in the form of dissolved organic and inorganic carbon. And in addition, about the same amount is lost via CO2 evasion from the streams. So then, if we know the approximate carbon sink source strength of the various landscape components and the area contribution to the catchment, we can make a first rough partitioning of the landscape carbon balance. So we have a net uptake of 1.1 tons of carbon, which can be attributed to an uptake of 0.05 from the peatlands within the catchment. This also includes emissions from the lakes of 0.01 tons of carbon, as well as emissions from stream evasion of in the order of 0.05 tons of carbon, which then leaves a residual estimate for what is going into the forest, which is then in the order of 1.11 tons, which is 111 grams per square meter. If you then take the net vertical exchange and subtract the lateral export of carbon from the landscape, we end up with a final annual net carbon uptake of about 1 ton carbon per hectare. I want to stress that these values are from preliminary measurements, and we will further refine these measurements over the next couple of years. One can also go one step further and still account for the biomass that is lost via harvest, which, based on annual reports from Holmen and Sverskog, can be in the order of 0.7 to 0.9 tons of carbon per hectare. Those numbers are, though, for all of Sweden, so they might be a bit different for the boreal region. Anyhow, this first rough compilation here suggests that there's a small net uptake occurring within the landscape. So in summary, to answer the question, is the managed boreal landscape a carbon sink? Our data so far, which is, as I said, preliminary data at this point still, based on 11 months of measurements, suggests, yes, it is a sink overall. However, we need to do more work to understand the interannual variability, which we have seen previously at the stand level, can be quite significant. And this is needed to understand the long-term carbon balance of this landscape. We also need to do more work with the footprint model to understand the sink source distribution across the landscape. And we further have to refine this bottom-up estimate. If there is accumulation of carbon, as it seems based on this first rough estimate, then it will also be interesting to understand if this accumulated carbon occurs, how much of this carbon goes into the soil or into the biomass, which then determines possibly the further fate of this accumulated carbon. And of this year, then, we also include measurements of methane so that we are able to also provide the greenhouse gas balance for this landscape. Finally, I would like to acknowledge my other project partners here in this project. Specifically, I would like to highlight Jackie, who has been processing and calculating all the eddy-currents fluxes. Then I would like to thank the staff from the Zwappelt Field Station for all their contributions. Specifically, Michael and Holger, who have been taking care of the instrumentation of the Svappberget flux tower. And I also want to thank the IQ Sweden team and the curriculum team, which have been contributing to this work. And Blaise and William have contributed the lake data and the maps from the curriculum catchment for this specific presentation. And finally, I would like to acknowledge funding from Formas, ICOS, Sites, VR, and SLU. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Matthias. If we do some quick mathematics here, you say that it's a little bit more than a ton of carbon per hectare a year. If we assume that 50% of the dry biomass is carbon, and the wood density is something like 0.4, and there is a biomass expansion factor that is less than 2, then you come up to figures with around 3 to 4 cubic meters per hectare a year as an average site productivity, which seems to be relatively reasonable if you turn this into more traditional figures. So you seem to be quite
on track.
Quite on track, yeah.
Okay.
So do we have questions for Matthias? Anders? Mm-hmm.
Maybe an ugly question.
Yeah.
The Krykland catchment is located on a slope.
Yes.
Have you considered anything about the advection, possible drainage of CO2 from the area? In the air, I mean, not from the streams. And how will you solve it?
Yeah, good, very good question. We are aware of it, and we are considering it in that sense that we are thinking about it, but we have not done a detailed analysis on it yet. The advection, in my view, is specifically a problem on the stand level scale. And for that reason, I've shown you there's a second eddy flux system of just above the canopy, and we have actually an additional flux system below the canopy to understand if there's some decoupling and advection happening within the vicinity of around the tower. But then if we go to the landscape scale, then in my view, the advection is an issue of scale and time, because whatever we don't measure at a certain time, we might measure in the morning when turbulence brings up the CO2 below the canopy in terms of time, but in terms of space, the CO2 that's traveling via advection out of a stand would come up somewhere else within the landscape. And if we measure at such a landscape level, this stand level advection due to nighttime drainage or decoupling, I think it would be more easily captured at such a scale and not be such an issue as it is at the stand scale. But I have to prove it somehow.
It's a minor detail.
Yes.
Okay. Do we have more questions? If not, it's 11:59. We are 1 minute ahead of schedule. Mm-hmm. I think it's time for a lunch break. Those of you that knows that you have informed Annika Mossing that you will want to have lunch, you say Future Forest when you come to the restaurant. The other ones, it's up to you to decide whether you have talked to Annika or not. So, but we will meet here again 1 o'clock sharp. Okay, see you then. Okay, I hope that you have all enjoyed lunch, and that now with a refreshed mind we will leave the stand and lake landscape scale and enter the regional and national scale. So I welcome Hans Pettersson, who is, I think, the leading expert in Sweden when it comes to at least reporting carbon and understanding also the policy relations when it comes to carbon accounting. But we will focus on the kilos of carbon and tons of carbon today. Welcome, Hans.
Yes, thank you. I'm a researcher in forest inventory and sampling, and I've been involved in this Swedish carbon reporting on the climate under the climate convention for more than 15 years. I'm the expert of land use change, living biomass and dead wood. And my colleague Matthias Lundblad, he couldn't make it today, but he is the expert on soil organic carbon and litter. Content. First, I will begin discuss like a different inventory designs for different purposes. And then I will describe this carbon stocks in Sweden. We reported under this convention and under the Kyoto protocol. And then I will finalize with some kind of speculation discussion of the role of forestry from a climate perspective. So, a monitoring design aims to monitoring things, stock change in stock, maybe by the NFI, and the intention is to measure how much. Then you maybe are familiar with experimental design that aims to prove some kind of relationship, and I say that it explains why. Then we have the edicovariance design that identifies a lot of processes. The carbon reporting is mainly based on the Swedish National Forest Inventory, the NFI. And the idea is to use sampling techniques. So we have 30,000 permanent sample plots, well spread over Sweden. And the idea is to carefully measure the variable of interest on these sample units. And thus most of the uncertainty will arise from that just a sample and not the entire population is measured. So that's the idea. Sample. We could say that this has happened. We could describe stock change in stock, but we can't explain why. Then the next thing is the experimental design. You maybe are familiar with this, but then we have a well-defined area. We can do it all over the country. And we manipulate those variables we are interested in. We, for example, check what happens if we fertilize. Is there any correlation with the growth? So does the growth increase? This could be updated with your, if you introduce fertilization or irrigation. And you should have a random process here. And you will keep everything except what you started constant. And the thing is, if you come up to it, as you have 20 to 1 back if you fertilize. Could you generalize this result for Sweden? Probably not. But you prove that it's a race relationship. Then we have the covariance method. This also a well-defined area, and normally it's undisturbed by the researcher. It could be disturbed by man or by natural disturbances. You have no random process, and the generality is the high resolution data. You can see study variables over the day and night, over 1 year or similar. And you have a lot of interaction you can study, and you have a lot of variables, and it creates a lot of questions that you maybe could prove with combined things that go back to the experiment design. And that's exactly what the presentation before lunch was about, that we have a lot of things interacting and it influence on the fluxes, and then we try to explain why. But in our case, design is to monitor and show how much, not why. This is the official figures reported for the land use change and forest sector submission 2017. You could see now, we discussed it in the morning, but now negative signs is a net removal, that when you remove carbon from the atmosphere down, and an emission is positive. So we could see that the living biomass pool increases each year in Sweden. This is also the case for deadwood, and deadwood is this, according to NFI, lying in standing deadwood trunks, but also in stumps. The biggest one is the stumps. We also report emissions from litter. The soil organic carbon, we have a large removal in the mineral soils. This is inventory by the soil inventory, Swedish National Soil Inventory, and we model emissions from organic soils to be emission. Finally, we have this on forest land harvested wood products. And this is the change in the stocks. All these are stocks. And we use the stock change method. So if the number of wood increases, or the wood increases in products, then we can get credits from this for Sweden if it increases. If you leave the forest land, we also have reporting from all other managed land use, and it's cropland, grassland, and settlements. And here we have report large emissions. And it's mainly the soil and organic soils on cropland ends up in this emission, but we also have emissions from living biomass when we have deforestation. This first one is about 3 megatons, the second is about 2 megatons. Under the LULUCF sector, we also report methane and nitrous oxide in if forest fires, fertilization, drainage, and this kind of nitrous oxide emission from drainage is, stands for most of this emission. Now I will continue with describing, could we trust these figures? That's the next point. So for the living biomass pool, we defined us as trees that are bigger than 1.3 meters. So we actually think that shrubs and smaller trees are in some kind of steady state. It doesn't matter. We report for our three species in Sweden. We don't have more, nearly. So we have models for pine, spruce, and birch. We apply the birch functions for all broadly species. And even if we say we should overestimate by 50%, it doesn't matter so much because there's not so many on national scale. We also have the models are based on Marklund's data set. And he inventoried trees from 129 stands representing all Sweden. And it, in total, about 1,300 trees. So we actually don't measure on the plot. We should carefully measure on the plot, but we don't measure. So instead, we use empirical models. Marklund also inventoried around 660 below ground biomass trees, but it's quite costly. And he was only interested of this biomass for bioenergy mainly. So we complemented it with another 100 trees. So we have the same design, but we traced roots out in the soil down to 2 millimeters. So we actually calibrate these models. And down to 2 millimeters. Finer roots are operationally considered to belong to the dead organic matter pool or the soil organic carbon pool inventoried by the soil inventory. So we come up with a net removal that is quite large. The good thing with this sample base is we could have a quality declaration. And it's about 3 megatons. The model error have been estimated only 1% for change in stock, around 10% for stock, but we're interested in change in stock. So I would say that the change, reported change in living biomass is quite accurate. And how do we do this? This is one of 30,000 plots. The field crew from NFI goes out in the field, come back after 5 years. If the trees are still there, the trees have probably grown a little bit, then these plots represent a removal. If they have been harvested, the plots represent an emission. Quite simple. And quite unique for the Swedish NFI is that we have covered all land from before the base year, 1990. The NFI started in the permanent plots was introduced in 1983. So the stock change. We have a standard estimator of this, sample based. So this is how you estimate the change in stock, and you have a variance of this. This is the quality declaration. And actually we have used, this is one of 30,000 plots, and this now we entered 6 times. So we have the position of the trees, we have the biomass of this tree. This specific tree was harvested between 2003 and 8, and reported under deforestation. While this new one here is reported under forest, remaining forest. And we also have the position of stumps after harvest, so we could trace them in the future. Changes in deadwood. The NFI defines lying in standard wood as trunks of deadwood longer than 1.3 meters, and it should be at least 10 centimeters in the top end. And what the NFI crew, they estimate the volume per 5 decay classes in field. And we collected 2,500 samples from temporary plots. All these measurements took them to lab and analyzed the carbon. So we have conversion factors per decay classes. I think it's quite stable and correct. So I trust these figures too. And we measure this as a stock change. It's exactly the same way as the living biomass. Then we have a little bit more uncertain estimate. This is the stumps. We know exactly how much trees are harvested. And since we don't use the stumps for bioenergy nowadays, we assume that all are kept, but we also studied that in the NFI. So we have the inflow from the harvest and outflow. That's the weak point that we have based on 40 trees, the K models. That, so we say that each stump each year will be decaying by 4.6%. That's the weakness of this estimate. Since this is a flows, when you have flows of inflows and outflows, then you have to go back in history. Because if you start now, the stock will increase. But if the inflow is exactly the same as outflow, sooner or later it will reach some kind of steady state. Now we are into not my area, but in the soil and litter area. So the changes in litter are first we have the coarse litter. We have no idea how much this is. So we just assume that it's 15% of deadwood is those that are not enough, big enough to be dead, lying instead of dead wood, but not so small that are included in the soil inventory. So this is a weakness. We just assume this. Based on I was out on the plot and estimated it. Expert judgment. Annual litfall is based on crude models, and you could see the variables per tree species, and it's imperial models, but I would say that they're not so accurate. Then we had a fine litter, and that is actually based on measurements, and they have up to 6,000 plots in the soil inventory, so they take a core and measure, and for some reason, the litter is a large emitter now for this period. So this is measured as an emission. The good thing is that these two are probably quite small, and it's the big one and an emission from this litter. Soil organic carbon. The soil inventory, they dig in the ground, and they measure the carbon concentration in different heights, and then they interpolate data between these. They have one measurement here, and one here, and one here. So they have the bulk density. You exclude boulders and actually this is the soil, and you have the height of this section. So they measure this, the carbon content, the organic carbon, and in the mineral soil, this ends up in a small removal. You can see that the inflow from litter fall and etc. is increasing now, and outflow is smaller than inflow. Don't know why, but it's like that. Dr. Haddon had some interesting in organic foliar soils I saw in the thesis, and how do they estimate the emissions from the actual emissions from this organic soils. So the drain soils is based on kind of emission factors times an area. And the emissions factors are based on nutrient content in the types of rich and poor land and some kind of forest type or forest climate type. They did an alternate way of allocating this by hydrology, and they got on national scale it was more or less the same, so they have gone for this first version. But of course, this is quite crude to have crude emission factors and times an area. On organic soils, on cropland, then we have something called the ICBM model, and they use. I have 8 regions, 9 crops, different crops types, and 14 soil types. So they have 1,008 different combinations of parameters. This emission or removal will only change if these parameter changes. So that's the emissions and the estimates are based on these set up. And drain organic soils are estimated to be crude emission factors and assumed to be a large emitter. So there are a few experiment designs behind these figures. And the result is like this. And they said, according to Matthias, that it was not the management of the soils that was important, as Dr. Haddon said. They thought it was more the soil type, the hydrology, I would say it is quite similar, because if you cultivate, you influence on the hydrology. So I don't, that's not my area, but, and it's soil type, hydrology, and structure, what that is, I don't know. Finally, we have the last carbon pool. This is the harvest wood products. And this account of something called a production approach. So Sweden reports all harvests that originate from Sweden, Swedish forests, wherever they occur. So if we export 85%, so if a share is located in Germany, we get credit for that if this shares increases the number of shares. So that's how it works. Just a matter of system boundaries. They have, if the harvest is the inflow, then the decomposition or the decay of this are crudely modeled by an outflow, a half-life of these three products. And they are the same for every year. Probably not correct, but that is the way they do it. Also here, since the flows, we have to go back long ago when they start with about 1900. So if the harvest increases, then this pool should increase. We don't directly consider the substitution effect within this sector. But since the harvest stands for about 120 megatons each year from Swedish forest, and the emission from all other sectors are 54. So most of this biomass could substitute fossil-based alternatives by the consumer. That could be Sweden, but it's mainly abroad. So if you are tactical from an accounting perspective, you should keep it in the country. But that we should maybe not do that. So actually, the accounting works in the way that you get credit for net removals in the forest, plus indirectly by substitution, if you use the biomass for substitution. And if all biomass are used for substitution, then the net plus the substitution is same as the growth. And you avoid emissions from soil. But if credits increase growth, that's good. Now it's Matthias' picture. Today we're going to discuss also if forests are sinks and sources. And in average, we found out that the living biomass, dead wood, and soil are a removal, constitute a removal or from the atmosphere, while the litter is an emission. But the problem stands that are for a rotation period are large removals or sources, sinks and sources. And in this case, we assume that the organic soils are large emitters. Finally, I will come to my last slides. And then now it's more speculation. So what is the role of forestry from a pure climate perspective? Does it matter if the forest is a singular source? So if we use... First, we just discuss production forest. Otherwise, we could have a discussion about biodiversity, but we take that as what is decisions makers decides how to compromise with biodiversity. But so we just study the production forest now. We could, of course, minimize emissions from the non-biomass pools, of course. But we just studied living biomass. So if you have this cycle and use all this bioenergy for substitution, then we maybe not have to use so much fossil-based alternatives. If we instead leave the forest for free growth, okay, we have some storage in them, but we have to rely on fossil fuels. But the problem is that if not used, the growth peaks. This is Harry Eriksson's research, different site indices, and you can see that it peaks. Actually, usually go down a little bit, but probably it ends up, it culminates off the peak. And Professor Lindroth today, he studied, this is all, only the growth in stems, but you studied the net ecosystem exchange, I would call it, something like that. And I studied after 600 years, for all fluxes were quite close to zero. So they seems to reach the steady state, if undisturbed, probably. So that's probably okay. So, when should we harvest? We should harvest when average growth peaks. Otherwise, we lose growth for substitution. So if we harvest here and here or here, it doesn't matter much because it's quite, the lower sighting is, the more flat this curve is. But also here, Professor Lindroth showed us, interacted by this, there was the European scale, then you could translate into the net sources, and in the beginning of this rotation, it was an emission from source, is in the after final felling, and then it peaked and go down. So it looks, the curve is similar, and the difference with this is just the living biomass, and you included everything. So, to avoid the loss of growth, that all forests knows, you should harvest something like here for this specific stand. But what happens when we include these other pools? This is the stem growth. You know that the tree starts building up its foliage, branches. So it's probably peak earlier if you consider the whole tree biomass than the stem growth. Because all these, Harry Eriksson's last was stem growth. So this, the peak will be earlier if you consider just biomass. On the other hand, whenever you go into a stand and manage, you probably have some losses from emissions from soil and litter. So maybe it's a good compromise to have this. But I think the within future forests have been researched that have actually considered this. If we go back here, if we could use sustainable, in a sustainable way, use 100 units each year, then of course it could be a discussion if you fertilize. Then you could increase this level from 100 to 150. But then, of course, you should have fertilizers that are based on not fossil-based, because that is possible, but most of the fertilizers today is fossil-based. Finally, of course, if this should work, then you should avoid management on some soils. Even I think in the long run, it's more important to study the substitution effect, but of course the storage in forests are important. And then I will end with saying that avoid management of some land that maybe holds a lot, stores lots of carbon. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you, Hans. I think that many of you thought that the eddy-covariance technique was something very complicated. I think that you have taken us to a new insights when it comes to carbon accounting. That is really something that is complicated. But it's also important, I think, for us to understand that at the policy level, it doesn't necessarily always follow the basics of natural science. There is a lot of assumptions and politics into this, so that's why it's quite a messy thing sometimes to figure out how it works. But I think that what you show is that in the long term there has been a steady carbon accumulation in the Swedish forest system. So in that sense, if you look at the whole landscape over a long period, there has the forest has been a sink.
Yeah.
And on top of that, there has also been a buildup of carbon in wood harvested products.
Yes.
And there has been some kind of substitution effect, which means avoided emissions from fossil-based sources. So in that sense, we can probably conclude that forest as a system on a national level, they are really... They are consuming carbon, they are accumulating carbon, and they still provide us with some material for consumption.
My point is that if you use the forest for maximize the production of biomass for substitution, then the optimal stock or the net removal in the forest should reflect that. And after infinite time, this sink should probably culminate. It should be the net removal force should reflect the maximum growth that is harvested and used for substitution. But now I'm only talking about climate. I'm not considering biodiversity, for example. So that's a political decision. And I don't think we should use all forest. I'm not speaking for using all forest for substitution, but maybe this is a sustainable way of using this resource, and of course we should reduce the emissions from other sectors mainly, but this is part of the solution maybe.
Okay, do we have questions directly to Hans from the audience? There is one in the center of the room.
Okay, my name is Magnus Mattesson, so I work for Biofuel Region. 1 week from now, the Swedish government will hand in its position on the LULUCF proposal from the European Union, which can, in the future, put a cap on how much we can harvest from our forest, because it's based on historical data on forest increment and on the forest harvest. It's based on the IASA data. I just heard from the Finnish ministry that it underestimated forest growth in the Finnish forest by 17 million cubic meters. So can you comment on this, and how can we really hand in some accurate data for the future possible harvest levels?
I'm a little bit involved with that. So how this model, the suggested model, works in the following way: that you have a reference line as a reference for forest management. That's just a crude business as usual projection. If you come over that limit, you get credits, and other you have to pay. But if you add the substitution effect to that, is that you actually could harvest, as long as you don't necessarily, you can take a debit from forest managed if you get it back from substitution in the other end. So I think the system works well. The problem, as you said, is the cap. Because the cap limits incentives to invest in forestry. Some countries maybe will get up here to plant new trees, afforestation, and increase the growth by fertilization, for example, and end up. Then we have more for substitution in the future. But that is heavily capped. This new suggestion. Another shortcoming with the model is that you cannot trade. You could trade if you don't fulfill your obligations under the LULUCF sector. You could pay with reduced emissions from other sectors, but not completely the other way around. I would say that they were quite limited. So you can't produce more biomass in the forest and increase emissions from the fossil-based side. I think it should be free trade, and each country should find their own solution. Each country could say that we will invest in new forests, other will reduce their emissions in other sectors. So that should be up to each country. But I think that the main problem with all this idea is the limits of trade and the cap on forest management. If Sweden have this reference line that's up here, this is just a negotiation about the commitment. We could have it here, and got, so that doesn't matter so much for the incentives, but it matters for Sweden. In Swedish accounting matters the line of this reference, but as I said, the main obstacle is this cap for future bioenergy, as I see it. And it's exactly what SLU sent in to the government a few months ago.
Okay. I still get extremely confused when I try to follow this discussion on the political level. And we, I think we still don't know what the final decision will be.
Yeah, no, we don't know. And it takes at least one day to explain how this...
And if you need a day to understand how it works, okay, then you can imagine that we will probably need some a week or so or a month. I don't know. But I think it's time. Now it's time for the discussion part of this seminar, and I hope that this is also the time when we will like solve the problem with the switch at Flakaliden and see whether we can figure out at least some possible explanations to the results that David has presented. So I think that we would like to see all the speakers here up front, and if I'm correctly informed, then most of you will be hooked up by a microphone. And you should sit over there. I think, David, you don't have a microphone, so we will share. So you will sit next to me then.
Okay.
På det anklagades bänk.
Ja. But I think that now when you have all listened to each other, if you have any short comments on the seminar so far, anything you want to add to what has been said already. If you start with Anders. You got like 1.5 seconds to prepare.
I think it has been very interesting. All presentations has really contributed a lot to understanding the whole, at least the one that I didn't do, but I listened to, was very good. So in that respect, I think it has been very, very good. I have learned a lot from this. So. I have actually one question to you. I think you wrote somewhere that the harvested biomass, some of the harvested biomass is immediately oxidized, calculated as it immediately oxidized. Is it that way, that it is, I mean, emitted in principle?
The principle is that the harvestable products is treated as a carbon pool. If the inflow, new harvest, is larger than the outflow, that's based on its half-lives, then you get credits for the increased pool. But most of these harvests are more or less used and going back to the... And if you, as a consumer, use that for substitution, you could reduce your emissions and on the other side on fossil-based emissions. Mm. So that's how it works. So it's kind of incentives for the user to substitute, but... So they get those credits, while Sweden, if we are the exporter, gets the credit for the pile of harvestable products. Mm-hmm.
Okay. So, but you, Hans, you have you just finished your talk, but I'm not sure. Do you have anything to add, or do you want to comment the other ones?
I think it was very very interesting. We have weakness in the reporting, and we come up to new ideas how it works. So I think this monitoring and research are complementing each other. So I think it was, I got a lot of things confirmed by this global flux measurements, all these 513 plots on the northern hemisphere, but it's confirmed what our figures, I think. So I think that was very interesting. And
yeah, but I think it's actually, well, I tried to, even though I have been quite occupied with the technical properties here, I have done some calculations here in my head, and it seems that most of the figures adds up to something that they are quite similar. Mm-hmm. When if you look at the stand over a whole rotation, or if you take the landscape over a year or a longer period, or if you take these national figures that you're presenting, they all come to some. There are 200 or 300 grams in NEE, and that figure that gives us something like on average 5 cubic meters if you calculate this on the stem wood production. So it seems to be. We are on the right scale, so to say. So it's just to get all these figures to match a little bit more. But I think that is something we should do more often to transform this currency into something that is common, so we can understand whether the absolute values are reasonable or not. But as far as I have seen today, they seem to be quite reasonable, actually. And you have all also agreed on that there are some uncertainties that we have to just accept, in fact. And
it seems that the National Forest Inventory may provide a powerful tool to detect whether the kinds of things that David has seen at Flakkeliden are occurring over the whole landscape. If the change is as big as what David has described, it should show up in the NFI data soon.
Assuming it is on a landscape scale.
Mm. Right.
But that's assuming it's on a larger scale than what we actually see.
Right.
Which.
And we have the unique setting that we have other flux sites in the near vicinity all around Vindeln, so we can compare if such shift also occurs in other nearby ecosystems, which is quite valuable.
Mm. Yeah, but I think that when we talk about, if we should perhaps focus a bit on David's results, because I think it's from an intellectual point of view, this is quite interesting, because this is something where we don't have an immediate answer, and as researchers, I think we like that kind of challenges, and we can have a discussion about okay whether it can be this or that explains it, and if this is the reason, then we should check it out like. Doing something, and then we like to do additional measurements or something like that. So it might be that we can be extremely constructive, but I think that you, David, you indicated very strongly that there has to be something related to respiration. And if it's respiration, then there must be something organic that is used. And you indicated that there was a stem, that the stem wood was affected by rot. But I think that, Torne, you also indicated that there was this increase in litter fall due to the needle rust. Have you been able to figure out what's the absolute amount of that? Because if I calculate this correctly, which is probably not the case, but if there is a shift from from minus 140 to plus 140, that corresponds to, if it should be only litter, then it should be an increase. Well, then the normal litter fall is something like 2 tons, then it should be an increase up to 5.6 tons or something. Is that possible?
No.
Uh-huh, that was that. what's the size of the litter fall?
I mean, the answer to your first question, have I been able to find the data? No. But I don't think we can explain, what is it, 280 grams per meter square in a year. But I think maybe a third or half of it. But what I wonder, if you look at this as as a pool. It's not only that you drop needles, you're also, there's a lot of new respiration occurring because of these pathogens. It's not only that they cause the litter to fall earlier, they invade the needles and then they would respire a lot.
But isn't it also so that this rust is it's attacking the current needles?
Yes.
And that should, in some way, it should affect the photosynthetic capacity. Should
and that's be a strange thing.
So there should David, be a drop in the other end, too. So
yeah, David, you were saying that there is no change in GPP, so that was a surprise.
So the gross components, the respiration and the GPP, they are, in a way, modelled from our net ecosystem exchange. So they are the way we separate our net ecosystem exchange, there is margin for error there. So and these gross components, they're so a small change impacts the net on a large way. So although we don't see any change in the GPP, there could be a marginal change that we're not picking up. And just to add, on the litter fall, I think this shift, we can't place it onto one change, so more needles falling, for example. But you did mention that this will also stimulate more respiration from other organisms. And I think that it's an accumulation of different processes that are occurring, and not only one singular process.
You were on first.
Also the GPP effect, the effect on photosynthesis, might not be detected, because it's been shown that if you take an age class of needles away, the remaining needles increase their photosynthetic rates in such a way that it might compensate completely. So in a way, it doesn't surprise me that you haven't seen differences in the photosynthetic rates of the whole canopy.
I have a technical question to David about the edicovarians. The analysis of nighttime respiration is not so simple and straightforward, and that's what you are using when you estimate your model for respiration. And one thing I don't recall from reading the paper that you mentioned what threshold you used for the U-star. This is a technical thing, the U-star correction. Or did you have the same all the period, or did you change it?
Yes, we just had a fixed U-star of 0.2 for the whole period.
For the whole period, yep. Okay.
So it was rough in that regard. Yeah. Of course, we could refine that
more. Yeah, but I think that's good, because then we know that it is not because you made some automatic adaption. There are methods to do it automatically, but that's a risk, I think. In this case, if you had the same threshold, I think it's good. But I have another question, if I may, Mr. Chairman. The mean temperature is a very poor explanatory variable for net ecosystem exchange or respiration. So I wonder if you also looked at the distribution of temperature, that you had other pattern in the autumn or something, that you had bigger variation, which could affect also.
I think in the manuscript, I didn't present it here, but I showed a distribution frequency, a frequency distribution for temperature in the autumn and the spring, for example, and they fitted very well.
Okay.
So the distribution wasn't, and that's partly what drove me to separate when is spring, when is autumn. Okay. It was driven by this.
Final question then. in the autumn, the photosynthesis stops because of light limitation, but if the season, autumn season, is longer, for some reason, then the respiration would go on. And did you see something like that, or?
It was hard. That's hard to detect, because if we have increased respiration anyway from something, we don't.
But from temperature, right?
From temperature, we didn't see anything from no dry from temperature.
Okay.
And that was what we actually expected to see that from previous literature, but we didn't. We couldn't detect it.
Okay.
But of course, we couldn't pick it up.
Mm. Okay.
Okay. Do we have more suggestions? On we have some. There are some ideas here that there might be something to do with this rust, that there is an increased amount of litter, that there might be some additional effects due to this decomposition of the litter. There has been a discussion about the autumn. John has
sort of a practical suggestion, and that is that there is a lot of data at the Flocculidan fertilizer experiment just down the road that could answer some of these questions. I don't know that it's your responsibility at this point to do it. I don't think it is your responsibility, but maybe it's for someone in the audience to do, to make that comparison between what David's observed and what's been measured on the Flocculidan plots, where litter fall has been measured, for example. So I guess I would just encourage somebody to do something with that connection, because I don't think it's really been made yet, not as well as it might have been.
I just could add to that, if I remember correctly, there used to be an edicovariant system down at the treatment area, which is discontinued now. It would be interesting to, even for a short period, run something there and compare these plots with what we're seeing now, just to see if it's something that's extended over the different stand types or if it's specific to our non-treated site. I think this would also be quite valuable to run.
An additional question now then. We know that we have run into shortage when it comes to this kind of financing some of the stations, and I think that the Flocculidan Tower is one of those that now runs out of money, and it seems to be a kind of a pity not to follow this development for another number of years to see whether it's, because if it's really related to what we can call a biological disturbance, then the stand should shift back again. And I think we need to know quite a lot more about I'm more nervous about what's happening in the soil. I see that we have Rita is here, and you are like also an expert on what's happening below ground. But if there for some reasons are things happening, so that something happens with the carbon pool below ground, that's quite a lot of carbon. So. But you might comment first on that. What will happen with the tower? Will you buy it privately and run it, or what happens?
Yeah, you're right. The funding's running out, and the tower is getting to the point where I'm a little bit scared to climb on it now. It's starting to rust and so on. But actually, we are we're applying for funding to upgrade the system. We also have a lack of auxiliary measurements, which makes it very hard for us to explain what we're seeing with our flux. So we'd like to upgrade the site and buy a new system that we'd mount parallel with the system we have now, just higher up, so that we can monitor our footprint, for example, to see if any shift has occurred there over a longer period. I think it's interesting, especially now we've had this thinning regime. It'll be interesting to see in a few years' time how that impacts the site. So if you have any money, then send it our way.
Okay, then can I ask you a question about the thinning? That everyone seems to be very enthusiastic about that, but I see it as a significant problem actually, because then we suddenly changes the stand conditions quite dramatically. I suppose they now have removed some 30% of the basal area, and it means that you should have a jump. And how do we then keep track on what is the effects of any kind of recovery and what is the result of the thinning? Have you any comments on that? Since you seem to be enthusiastic still, since you apply for money to follow what happens.
They removed more than 30% actually from this site, but we've kept a segment within our footprint unthinned, and this segment's large enough that for when the wind blows from that area, we will see how the forest is unthinned, and we can compare it to the rest of the footprint where it has been thinned.
Have we questions from the audience? We have Mats.
I'm a former professor here, Mats Hagner. I've done a lot of silviculture research. And I want you to, whoever will answer, no one have commented what we do with the clear cuts. We dig with big harrows and turn the soil over. Who has measured the effect of that? No one has mentioned it.
No, do anyone in the panel wants to I suppose you mean that you mechanically you introduce an extra disturbance in the silviculture program that increases the turnover of the soil organic matter. And I think that, but Anders, you have been working with that.
I don't have such data, but Monica Strömgren, is she here or no? She has made measurements in relation to stump harvesting and soil scarification. And she, if I remember correctly, she didn't find a big effect of the disturbance on the soil. Very surprisingly small. We had all expected that the disturbance, soil disturbance, should cause a lot of emissions. But as far as I can recall, it was practically no effect as we what she could find. And that was small plot, small scale measurements with chamber system. So I think it was something like a couple of square decimeters, but on different types of disturbance. But I think it was a good study. So I don't have any reason to think that it was something wrong with it. But that just one study. I don't know. There are not many studies on this, maybe in Finland, but not that I know of.
But when we are talking, when we are now on ground, so to say, I think we should take the opportunity to ask Rita, when you are here, that what's your thoughts about soil carbon, the long term accumulation? I think we have seen from Hans' presentation, but what will be in the future? How do you see this? Will there be a steady increase, or should we be afraid of some kind of net losses from the soil, or what will happen?
I don't think that we can expect any drastic decreases. That is what I think. Not other, because if the temperature, now I am not talking about David's results, but in general terms, that if climate change happens and continues and temperature increases, then you get, of course, higher decomposition rate, but at the same time you get also higher nitrogen mineralization, which at least to some extent compensate the increased decomposition and decrease in carbon storage. So
what you're saying that we don't have to be very afraid of a carbon bomb from the soil.
Not in the boreal forest, but of course in peat soils. Without it, the soil carbon storage is always connected to above ground and or vegetation and production, plant production.
While Hans was indicating that one strategy for policymakers and landowners when it comes to combating climate change, that could be to increase growth and to keep the forest system as neither a sink or a source. In your terminology, I mean that what you mean is to increase growth and harvest everything annually, so there is like a steady state on. Then you have this, what I think, Matthias, you called it a horizontal transport. You increase the horizontal transport and call it logging, so that the carbon balance is zero. But if you increase growth above ground and harvest everything, what do you say, Rita, will happen with the soil system? Will there still be an increased carbon accumulation there then?
But could it be something else?
You are the expert.
it should increase.
Do we have more questions from the audience? And Torine, you haven't figured out the absolute values yet.
It's for David. I mean, I was just trying to read you the title of the paper that was published, and I guess I miss an A. A boreal forest is what you've been measuring on. When you say boreal forest, it's a general phenomenon then. Do you still think it is?
No, general? I think it's a boreal forest. But to paraphrase, I put boreal forest. I heard a rumor that titles that are short are read more, so I tried to keep my number of words down.
I think that was a very good answer. But we also discussed this over lunch. I think it's something we all should consider a little bit more. We talk about forests or the forest as if we are generalizing quite a lot. And we should be more careful with that, using that word. And when we are talking about a tree, then we talk about trees. If it's a stand, then it stands. It's a landscape. But the forest, it means so many different things. And especially for the audience outside of this room, if you go to the general public, when you say forests, then what they see in front of them might be something very different from the Frakaliden site with some half-dead spruces. Trying to survive with this tower looking down on them. So that might be a take-home lesson for all of us, to be a little bit more careful about how we communicate our results, because I think this is a general problem that it's almost always so that we are scientifically correct, but when this is communicated, then it ends up in... It's understood in very different ways than what we actually... thought that we were presenting from the beginning, and you saved an A. It was interpreted as the forest, which I think it's a bit unfair, but it's the way it is, and we can just be, I think, more careful. But then coming back to this, I still think that we shouldn't give up until we have a very good idea of how to come closer to. Why did this shift happen? Because if it's nothing wrong with the measurements, or if it's within normal uncertainties, so to say, then there must be a reason. And I think that there has been so far the two things that has come up. They are both related to respiration losses related to biomaterials. Either it can be from stem wood, it can be from the needles, and then there can be feedbacks from this. If the needles in some way has effects on GPP that you haven't observed yet, it might be that we can get all these figures together and explain most of these changes. Because I still also think that that the NEE before this shift is relatively low. I get this feeling that it's a little bit, there is something disturbing about that. It should be 30% higher or something to better represent the actual stem wood. The MPP woody biomass should indicate a higher NEE. And perhaps well, we should check out the stands more. We should check out when Torne figures out the absolute values of the litter fall, and perhaps also make some simple estimate on the amount of rot in the stand. Because that could be, there is already sample stumps there since it's
and we could also sample residual trees to see how much mass is missing.
Because it can be quite many kilos of the cellulose that has turned into carbon dioxide. Anders, you had some...
Yeah, I think one thing that about Flocalidin, I think it would be very interesting to have some estimates of NPP as well, to compare with the NEE numbers. As you say, it would give an indication. You saw my correlation there is relatively strong, so I think it would be useful to have some NPP estimate. But it takes a lot of work and it needs money also. So it's not,
but I think it's the place to be if you want to do the MPP estimate. It's already too many data collected on that site, so it should be possible.
Yeah, it should be possible. Okay.
We have an additional question from Mats, I think.
Yes. No. Yeah. You hear me? Anyway, I have been working with continuous cover forestry for a very long time. As a result of that, I think we will long-term produce about the same amount of wood
in clear-cutting system and in continuous cover system. But Anders Lindroth, you have written a story in a paper in southern Sweden telling that if we turned into continuous cover forestry instead of clear-cutting, the whole Swedish forest would consume as much more carbon dioxide as the whole national Swedish national emission. But how could that be if the forest, continuous cover forestry, is not producing much more wood? Please.
Well, it has to do with what I showed you, the emissions in the beginning when you clear cut. If you can avoid these emissions and you can maintain the high NPP level all over the whole period, that would have such an effect, because the emissions are substantial during the first 10 years or something like that. So it's a very simple calculation and based on that assumption. But of course it then means that you must be able to maintain a high NPP production over, well, continuously in comparison to what you do with this kind of clear-cut system. So it's of course unfortunate that we don't have any such systems where we could do long-term measurements of the whole ecosystem exchange. That would give us some indications and answers. So what we have done is, in one of the forests I'm working in, Norunda, there we made a thinning, which is in a way resembling what you will do in continuous cover forest, even if it's not based on the same strategy on what trees you will select. It was from a classical forestry management point of view the thinning was made. We see some effects of it, but not very big. And actually I'm working on analyzing this data now. We hope to present it in the EDU meeting in April. But we see some effect of the thinning, but not very much. And to me, that's an indication that if you can maintain the forest floor vegetation more or less undisturbed, if you can harvest without making a lot of disturbance, and keeping the active canopy layer as intact as possible, then you will also have a high NPP production over time. Another thing that I didn't mention when we talked about the disturbance is that we do see also other greenhouse gases coming from the clear cuts. We have emissions of methane and N2O, and that because the hydrology is very much changed when you clear cut. You will get a much higher groundwater level, and then it means that you can have methane also, from depending on how the drainage conditions are and so on. So that's another thing of the story here, that's also something that will never happen if you have a continuous cover forest, for instance.
Yeah, but I think what you're pinpointing here is that there is a strong need for some further investigations where we can compare NEE with the NPP, especially NPP woody biomass in different management systems, and to get this done for quite long periods. It's another indication that there is still some research to be done.
We need more money.
Yeah, again, now it is said for the first time. But we have a question here from Sveaskog.
Yeah, my name is Jessica Nordin and I work at Sveaskog. We kind of got surprised when we saw the results from David's thesis, so therefore I'm here today to learn more about it, and definitely I've done. I'm kind of surprised though, because when you saw this dramatical change in carbon uptake, and
when I've heard you today, I kind of surprised that you never seem to have looked on how did the stand look like. I mean, now we have talked about maybe it's because of rust or root and everything, but it seems to be a gap between, like, since I'm coming from a forest company, we used to work very practical. We look at the forest and how it's working and so on. But here it seems like it's kind of theoretical. So what is your comment about that? And the result of this, will this change how you will continue to work after on, if you're going to try to find the reasons for this dramatically change and so on?
So, yes, we tried to look at the forest, and of course we saw that the forest understory was quite dark, for example, and we speculated that we'd have this litter fall. But to prove that is very tricky. To satisfy that this is the cause, we can only speculate, and I think I did speculate in the paper to some extent. We didn't discuss back in time how the forest was before this plantation was put there, what was there previously. That probably has an effect on what we're seeing today. The carbon in the soil must have come from somewhere, previous forests, for example. But again, it's down to auxiliary data. I mean, we need to measure leaf area index, for example, frequently, litter fall, soil temperature, soil moisture. All these measurements are required. And when you have a system that's running for so many years, to keep this running continuously was very hard. So it's been a challenge to look at the forest that way. And then to continue to investigate this, of course, it would be silly just to say this is happening and not investigate it further. So that's why we are going to, well, hopefully continue measuring there if we can, to see how things will change after thinning. But also we're open for collaboration. If people have ideas and would like to work within the site, people are very welcome. It could only be good.
No, I think it's great to hear that we will not leave this question about the flock or leader shift. But I know that there is one person that will leave, and that is Matthias, because he has another seminar to prepare. That Gunnar Ökvist will be visiting our department within some 15 minutes,
yes,
or something like that. So I suppose, if you want to advertise that, or if you want to give a final comment, or if you just want to leave, it's up to you.
I think it's a trick question. I do can make a final comment to the Flakkaliden situation before I leave. Because what leaves me a bit still puzzled after discussing the different options that has caused this change, it's a question, is it a switch or a shift from sink to source? Because a shift would imply that there has been some gradual change in the ecosystem structure, for example, self-thinning over time as the stand gets denser, or the development of stem rot over time. But these changes do not happen from one year to the next, causing such a switch from one year to the next. But if it was a switch due to a disturbance event, for example, from needle rust, or that produces some sudden change, then I would expect after this initial 1 or 2 years of disturbance, some sort of a recovery pattern, which within these 5 years of being a source, I could not see, even though one has to account that there's some inter-annual variation that maybe masks such a pattern. But this is what leaves me a bit puzzled. It's not a clear sign for a switch or a shift in the possible reasons.
But I think that when you look at the rust, it's not a switch. This is a shift. It develops gradually, and it can be a 1 year event, but it can also be repeated attacks. So it could actually still be this rust creating a shift, a switch.
I guess what I was trying to say is that if it is a shift, as you pointed out, then the annual balance should also have been gradually shifting over several years, being a bit of a source, a bit of a sink, eventually turning out just to be a source. But in this data, it's from 1 year to the next being a continuous sink into being a continuous source.
But now I really have to leave. Thank you very much. I hope that some of you join our seminar at the department at 2:30 still in our FICA room. Thank you.
Thanks. Now you managed to advertise too.
Yes. Perfect.
Yeah, we will very soon finish. There was a comment or a question from Hans and from Vaughan.
Just comment. The problem is when we just have one stand, we study, we have changed suddenly, and that is not what we expected. But we don't, until the unexpected event happened, then we think everything is okay. But we don't stress, was it before this? So it's very risky when we generalize our idea. Now we don't know exactly what happened. And then, so I mean that it's very risky to draw conclusion from this. And also if I go back to Anders here, when we have one stand representing continuous forest and one or several stands representing other systems, I would say that I wouldn't evaluate any management system based on a short period. But of course we get information about how it may, but the risk, all this risky to generalize things with such layout. So go back to the experimental design.
Anders, I suppose you want to comment
actually,
the comment.
Actually, it was a follow-up to the lady from Sveaskog. I didn't recognize your name. But I think what you said is very important, and my colleague and friend Sune Linder, he always said that you should always have a biologist also together with a micrometeorologist in your flux studies, because we miss things if we don't have that. And I'm quite convinced that if we have had Sune in place in Flakaliden all the time, we would have known much more about this. But so I think it's a good thought for the future to try to not only have the experts on the method or also on the biology of the system. That's what I think.
I agree, but to give ourselves credit, I would say we're doing it now. It should have probably happened before, but at least we're doing it now.
Yeah, yeah.
I think Juan, you had a question.
Yeah, I guess it was more a question generally for eddy covariance guys. I mean, how well can you resolve the respiratory release from these forest stands? Because, I mean, this looks like a step change that's, what, 2-3-fold, which is beyond a 2-year period. So that's the first question. And the second question is, having observed that, how on earth did you not go out and measure it to confirm it? Because that's such an extreme event to have occurred in nature without there being a massive outbreak of insects or something. For the stand to have remained intact and to have doubled or tripled its respiratory release, it just doesn't happen.
Yeah, I was not quite following the whole question, but... Yeah. Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. So first of all, then I think what you also said was that this change in the net ecosystem exchange, that's simple. We can measure that quite accurately. So I don't doubt this result. Of course, the separating of our net into compartmental gross components, that's tricky, of course. And the way we did it was by using the nighttime respiration. And it's a commonly used method so far, but it is a little bit rough. So there are elements of error there. But I don't think it's off the scale wrong. I still believe that they are relatively correct. And you say that it's this large momental shift. But if we, it's a question of time again. If we look at the net, 4 years before the shift, the net uptake was declining year on year. It was decreasing. And then it became a source. But what before we were measuring, what happened then? Is this something that's happened regularly, that perhaps you have 5 years of a source, then 20 years of an uptake, then 5 years of a source again? We don't know. So when we say this momental shift, I think we are over, exaggerating it somehow. I think we should look at it on a large perspective also. I don't know if that answered the question. Maybe someone wants to build on this.
It is very difficult if you want to extend the nighttime data into the daytime and the whole year. But actually, you could use only the nighttime data and just look when you have good turbulence conditions, and then you would be absolutely certain that this is real what you see, because then you don't involve a lot of assumptions and things like that. And I'm quite sure that if you would do that with your data, you would see.
That's a really good idea.
Yeah, yeah. So that's something that you can definitely do.
Okay, having all the forest experts in one room, I will grasp the opportunity for a question on a general level. And we have seen some indications in the results being presented here today that if we will have longer periods in the forest with high temperatures, but we will not have a vital growing forest during all that time, that we can increase the risk of carbon leakage due to decomposition of organic matter and also due to increased risk of bugs and fungus and stuff attacking our forest. So do we face a risk of increased carbon leakage due to climate change?
I think that could be almost the last question that we can have in the panel. You can speculate in that. But before you start to speculate, now I think that I think we should respect that there is another seminar within 5 or 6 minutes, yeah. And we should, even though this is a very interesting discussion, it's not the final and only discussion. I think it has been as John is saying, that this is just a start of future collaboration, and as Anders suggested, that there should be we should be more. We should really try to do this in a more, is it transdisciplinary way? That, I mean, that we have foresters, ecologists, biologists, meteorologists, physicists, that we work more together, because I think it's the only way to get forward. We have a good idea from Anders about how to reevaluate some of the data. There is this idea from Torne about the litter, and there is this idea that you came up with also about the stemwood decomposition, whether there's some rot or whether there are some other reasons. But I think that if we tomorrow start to think about how to collaborate on this within soon, the Flakaliden mystery will be solved. If you want to comment on the question, should we be staying awake during night and not sleeping very well because of some future carbon bombing from the ecosystems? What do you say, Anders?
I'm not so worried about the temperature increase, maybe, but more if there is a big change in storminess or wind frequencies. I think that's the real, and also precipitation might be, but not so much the temperature. So. I think there are some risk definitely that we should be thinking of and trying to prepare for. Even if the data on the storminess is very uncertain, but there are indications that it could increase in the future. And that could also cause some rethinking of how to manage the forest, I think.
Hans, are you nervous or not?
No, I'm not so nervous. Of course, any disturbance will change. If we increase the temperature, maybe the little fall will increase. But on the other hand, the microbes will increase the decomposition. So it will be stabilized on another level, probably, or will gradually change if the temperature is gradually increasing. I don't know, but there are forests in Skåne and it's up here, so the difference during the season and in the country is quite big now. So I don't think nothing will happen over one night.
What about John? Will you stay in Sweden?
I'm in Swedish. I don't know how to say rust in Swedish. For me, if the temperature increase that we know has happened has favored the rust, then. And if that becomes widespread, that could be a serious problem. Yeah. I don't know anything about the biology of rust fungi, but it seems like it would be good to both calculate whether there's enough carbon released due to this litter fall process, and Torgny is getting tired of being pointed at with this question, I can see it. But if we can convince ourselves that it could be that, then it seems like the next question is to find a pathologist who can tell us about whether they're likely to respond in that way to temperature rises, because the temperature is going to increase. And if that makes spruce unviable, then that would be bad.
They have a lot of seminars on that. It's just that you don't visit them.
No, I know. It's my fault. I take responsibility.
Okay, what do you say about that? I'm going to sleep well, I think. I don't think temperature directly won't scare me, but an indirect effect of temperature is a little bit more scary. Perhaps like rust spread or insect outbreaks or so, and that will have a larger impact, I think. But directly, temperature isn't too much of an issue.
Yeah, Mats. No, it's on your department that we will be late.
Just a response to your question. I mean, in much, maybe most of Sweden, one of the most severe constraints on forest growth, that's the soil frost and the snow in the spring. So if we have the more early onset of the forest growth we have, the larger will the increase of forest biomass production be. So I say there are as much argument that we actually might have an increase in CO2 uptake depending on an earlier spring offset, even if most research applications and many journal papers, everyone state that climate change only will end up in negative responses. That's not at all the only possible development, I would say.
Okay, with those words, I think that we have to close the seminar. And I would like to very much thank the speakers for giving us a share of their expertise and helping us to understand more of the complexity of the carbon balance of our forest systems. And so I think we give them some, what do you call that in English, a big hand or a big applause. And I would also like to thank all you here in the audience, because this is like a bilateral thing. It's the discussion that puts the front forward, so to say, when it comes to knowledge. So I hope this is not the last time that we have some kind of scientific discussion like this here. And with that, I give you 2 minutes, those of you that are interested in listening to Gunnar Ökvist.
One more thing. That, for the students in the room, this sort of thing doesn't happen after a PhD defense very often. And I think David was put in a rather difficult position, which I think he handled beautifully today. So I think we should give him a hand all by himself.